And there we go. All right, unhappy Wednesday, everyone. Coming to you live from my humble abode here in Fairfield, Ohio. This is the Unhappy Gilmore Show, powered by Green Legion Radio and part of the Green Legion Radio family. We thank you for joining us from wherever you may be and whatever service you're using to tune in. So please pull up a chair, turn up the volume, crack open a cold one if you feel like it on a Wednesday night, and let's try to have some fun as we put an end to day three of this week's hostage situation and look forward to tomorrow being Friday Eve. Anybody in the room already? You can see I have two very distinguished guests this evening. We're going to skip over the normal intro and get right to it. Chris Sack, Lou Dominguez, thank you both for your time. Appreciate you guys being here. What's going on, brothers?
I mean, age before beauty. Go ahead, Lou.
Great to be with you guys. As you know, we share this love and passion for the game of baseball. So happy to be with my brothers here talking the sport that we love.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, the fact that we're getting together and doing this, I mean, yes, Major League Baseball started this morning with a 6 a.m. game between the Dodgers and the Padres in Seoul, Korea. And then all of a sudden, like right before we're about to hop on tonight, there's all this Shohei Ohtani stuff is coming out. Like this, I didn't know this guy was such a degenerate gambler like Michael Jordan. It's pretty crazy to see. But people don't know this about the three of us. We've done this a couple times now over the last couple years. I had you guys on for an episode of Baseball Brunch. I think it was either last season or the season before when Murph wasn't available. Yep. But like, if you people would have the ability to read our text thread between the three of us, I mean, you know, probably have to send us somewhere out into the Bermuda Triangle for the things that we put in that group text thread. It's very interesting. It's a lot of fun. A lot of hatred on Biden, but it's a good time.
Yeah, definitely not for the faint of heart on the left side. That's for sure. Well, I'm glad you brought up the 6 a.m. game because, we do the boner of the week here every week. And for me, and I don't know how you guys feel, but for me, it's easily Major League Baseball. You got the biggest – so Shohei Ohtani is probably the biggest free agent we've ever seen, right? I mean, it's a two-way player, first guy to do it from a strong level on both sides since Babe Ruth, right? He goes and signs a 10-year, $700 million deal with one of the game's most storied franchises. And your answer to that is to have their opener, the first time you get to see Shohei, on the East Coast, not quite as bad at 6 a.m., but Dodger fans themselves out in L.A. have to get up at 3 o'clock in the morning to see their brand-new superstar.
And the Padres, both teams.
West and the Padres, teams. Yeah.
Can I formally say that I don't care about either fan base?
saying from a Major League Baseball standpoint.
That's what's in. But listen, I love what Major League Baseball does in releasing their schedule late July, early August. I really enjoy that aspect of it because I like looking, and we're going to talk about it, during the course of the show. I love looking ahead and seeing what I can pull off as far as the next ballpark or my next trip, my next venture, whatever I want to do. The problem in doing that and announcing it that early is, we all knew back in summertime that Shohei Ohtani was destined to be a Dodger. I think we all had that feeling. There might have been a couple dark horses, the Cubs, the Blue Jays, the Mariners. We all thought that there was something that we all knew he wasn't going back to the Angels. That wasn't happening.
If he was staying
in L.A., he was going to be a Dodger. But when you release that schedule, you already announce well before free agency that the Dodgers are going to be opening up the season in Korea against the Padres. So I understand the aspect of being mad with Major League Baseball. I don't even count today as like opening day in my eyes.
I don't.
It doesn't count to me. Like it's like, okay, cool. You're playing a couple games. You're playing them overseas and you're playing in Korea. It doesn't matter to me in the grand scheme of things. Opening day is next Thursday. That's when everybody opens up. That's when everybody gets going. That's the full bore, the full charge. These games right here, they count in the standings. But for me, nah, man.
It wasn't even on the radar for me, dude.
Like, not at all.
I'm not getting up at – I mean, first of all, I'm usually out the door before 6 o'clock in the morning. Second of all, even if I wasn't, I'm not getting up at 6 to watch the Dodgers and the Padres, dude. I'm just not going to do it. And if, if it was the Yanks, if it was, you know, if it was something I was actually interested in, I hate the Dodgers. So I'm not going to, like, put in that effort to get up that early and watch it. I do feel somewhat badly for their fans, though, dude. I mean, 3 o'clock in the morning, man, you may as well just party right through it, right? Yeah. Like, just go hit it hard the night before and just stay up.
Right.
Yeah, it's an all-night bender for sure.
Right.
Yeah,
most definitely. And both the Padres and Dodgers, by the way, are coming back and playing more spring training games before their official opening day. So that's nuts.
Which is completely insane. Yeah. I don't understand that at all. How is that even a thing? You already opened your season.
Right.
Now you have to take a whole week off, or no, let's go play more spring training.
Doesn't make sense.
What are we talking about here? So you're going to go from Shohei Ohtani and all these guys, you know, they basically tried to form the Justice League in Chavez Ravine, and now you're going to go back to watching guys who are going to be bagging groceries in a couple of weeks.
Right. No name in the back of their jersey.
Right. Hey, man, Kurt Warner bagged groceries. He was a pretty damn good quarterback.
Well, did he bag them or did he stock shelves?
He bagged the groceries. I mean, he needed to put a bag on his wife's head, but I mean, that goes well.
Especially with that haircut, dude. Oof.
Oh. Man, yeah. She looked like she belonged in NSYNC. It was just
pretty much. Yeah.
How about the? Let me ask you this about that Shohei contract. While we're still on the subject, they defer $680 million out of this.
Crazy.
It shouldn't be allowed. First and foremost, it shouldn't be.
Well, also, listen. It should not be allowed. But also, if I'm Shohei Ohtani, show me the money. The reason why Bryce Harper is no longer in Washington is because they offered him a $300 million contract, and they said, we're going to give you $200 million during the course of the contract, and then when you turn 60, we're going to give you $100 million after that.
Right.
Like I understand Ohtani is worth like $1 billion when it comes to like marketing and advertising and all that stuff, and he's going to make a ton of money in endorsements. All well and good for him. But
he's going to make the Dodgers a ton of money too.
To me, like $2 million is no fun. I mean, like, it's fun for me. It's fun for us. But like $2 million as a baseball player in a season, like, oh man, like I got to wait until I'm 40 to get $68 million. Kind of crazy.
That's exactly what it is. That $680 million is deferred until after the contract expires in 2033. I find it absolutely ridiculous.
I will say this, though. The fact that he's getting his money deferred was less money for his interpreter to steal from him. So in that case, he actually did well.
So who interpreted to Shohei that his interpreter was stealing money from him?
Yeah, whose hands are on that one?
Did the interpreter tell him I stole $4.5 million from you and I was betting it?
It's like going to work and one of the guys walks to try to give him direction. They tell you they don't speak English.
Yeah. Sammy,
he just said it to me in English, jackass.
So Sammy Sosa is still pulling that card 18 years later. So right.
Yeah, I plead the fifth. Way to go, Clemens. I don't know, dude. So 680 gets pushed out until after the contract expires. Are we going to be looking at the Dodgers in 10 years and calling them the Mets for the Bonilla thing, only like on steroids?
Yeah, I mean, absolutely. I don't think it's going to be as fun because, like, as much as you hate the Dodgers, everybody hates the Mets.
All three of us share that.
Yeah, that's the fun part of it with the Bobby Bonilla Day is because it's the Mets.
Well, it's money deferred from a season that he never actually played.
He never actually
played. That's the best part about it.
Well, it's kind of like Prince Fielder. Prince Fielder was the highest paid player the year of the pandemic. It was a 60-game season, and he's making over $20 million. You couldn't prorate the salaries for players that you bought out, you pushed it down the line, or retired.
Kicking the can, dude. Bonilla is still going to be getting paid after the Bryce Harper deal ends.
Nuts.
I mean, you can think about that, dude. The Bryce Harper deal, what is it, 2032? Is that when it's over?
It's 2032. It was a 13-year deal. Yeah. So the day that he had his press conference was the day that Carson was born. So I pretty much introduced him. I said, listen, this guy, you're going to be 13 when this guy's contract is over.
Right.
The funny thing is about that, and we're going to dive into the Phillies and all that stuff, is the fact that he's got
I'm going to give you your platform to brag.
Well, I there's some to brag and there's some that you're worried about, but the fact that he's 31 years old and he's got 8 years left on his contract and he's already talking about an extension, pump the brakes.
Yeah, easy, bub.
Yeah.
You've already moved to first base here. Like, you know.
Yeah. Pump the brakes, dude. Like, if you win me a World Series, then I'm willing to give you a lifetime contract. I got no problem with it. But, like, guys like Jimmy Rollins and Chase Utley didn't finish their careers in Philadelphia. Cole Hamels did not finish their careers in Philadelphia, and they brought home the ultimate prize. And, like, we talk about it all the time in the group text thread about who's more tortured and whatnot. Obviously, I am. I'm a Philadelphia sports fan through and through, and I've got two to my name in my lifetime. But it just – to sit there and think that we're just going to give this guy – and he's had two amazing postseasons the last 2 years – that we're going to extend an eight-year extend more years onto an eight-year contract that is left on there is just egregious. It's stupidity, and anybody that wants to sit there and try and side with Bryce and Scott Boras in this is, you know, they're just a fanboy. They just – you know, Bryce can do whatever he wants. No, he can't.
No. At some point, it is still a business. It is still a business. Obviously, us as fans, the business we want it to be is winning. But, you know, like you just said, 31 years old, 8 years left on the deal. You're 39 when that one expires. Mm-hmm. And you've already had to move to first base as a permanent thing. Yep. When you came in, you were an outfielder. You're a right fielder and a damn good one. And now injuries and stuff happen. But, like, you've already made that move. So where does it go from here? How much more are you going to have to step back? You're going to be a full-time DH by the time you're 36 and still want that contract extended? That seems a little much to me.
And he's had – and listen, he's had injuries since he's been here. I mean, I think the clean bill of health that he's had in 1 year – that was 2019. He didn't miss a lot of games in the shortened season in 2020, but he was laboring with a back issue. He got hit in the face with a pitch. He won with the facial lacerations that he had. He got hit by Blake Snell. You know, it's a lot of fluke stuff, like throwing a ball from right field, you know, against the Mets and tearing his UCL and having to get Tommy John. Like, a lot of this stuff is fluky, but at the end of the day, it's like you could say that about Embiid too. So it's like, when do you get to the point where you say enough is enough? Like, we're not going to extend your deal. You've got 8 years left on here. Prove to us that you can remain healthy. And I'll talk to you in 6 years.
But yeah, give me a few years clean.
Yeah.
And then we'll see where we're at.
Not doing that now. Love you, Bryce, but no.
You can't. You just can't do it. How about you, Lou?
Well, I'd like to, you know, stick to the injury theme here. All these pitchers, you know, granted they're older, but all these pitchers, sorry, Adam. I know that's hitting a nerve there with you. But it's concerning, man, having all these pitchers, all these aces out, you know, to start the year. And it's been the trend, you know, the last couple of years. And it makes you wonder. I know you want to coddle these guys, to your point, Chris. You want these guys to play, and you want to, wrap them in bubble wrap and make sure they're on the field. But at the same time, going back to the 60s and 70s, where if you didn't get a complete game, if your manager had to come up and you gave the ball up, there's a problem with you. Guys, you know, did a complete game with 12, 13 innings at times. I know it's a different time. You want to protect your investment, but what's the deal with all these rash of injuries to these pitchers? Is it the fact that they're being coddled too much?
Well, look at the top five pitchers in terms of salary in Major League Baseball. You know, like Scherzer, DeGrom, Verlander, Strasburg. Like, all these guys aren't going to be pitching either this year or ever again, or not until June or July. Garrett Cole out 2 to 3 months, you know,
I think that's best case scenario,
scenario, you know.
I'm not confident we're going to see Cole this season.
Right.
That's what a lot of people are saying. Yeah.
The rash of injuries that's occurred to the Marlins pitching staff. Oh. I mean, it's insane. What's going on? Like, you sit there and you look at the Dodgers. I mean, you know, Dustin May and Tony Gonsolin are going to miss the whole entire season. Walker Buehler's coming off of his second Tommy John.
Shohei Ohtani's got his second one.
He's not pitching this year. Nope. Tony Gonsolin, Clayton Kershaw's not going to be back in the rotation until July. Was it Tyler Glasnow? He's had two Tommy John surgeries. Yeah. I mean, like, you can sit there and say what you want about the Dodgers and how great they look on paper. You have three MVPs at the top of your lineup, one of the best catchers in baseball that's going to be right behind them, 1 through 4. That's fantastic. But also, like, you got to look at their pitching staff. It's like, how durable are they going to be? How much can they sustain? And it's all across Major League Baseball. Like, that's the reason why I'm happy that the Phillies have done what they've done as far as bringing back Nola. Say what you will about Nola and his inconsistency at the time, but the guy takes the ball every fifth day. And I'll take that every day of the week and twice on Sunday. And a guy like Zach Wheeler, who had the injuries earlier in his career, has found a way to keep himself on the mound. He's had a couple little bit of, you know, hiccups here and there, especially towards the end of 2022. But, like, I look at our starting pitching staff, and I think that's a benefit. The fact that, like, a Jordan Montgomery is still sitting out there, like,
right,
Adam, like, a team with you
I know
that has expectations, and I know you had Montgomery before, and he wasn't what he became, you know, in St. Louis and with Texas. No,
but he's a guy who can handle New York.
Correct. He's been there before. He's done it before. Yep. I don't have any understanding of what you guys are waiting for as far as giving him a deal. Not a 6-7 year deal like Boris wants, but at least give him 2 years, 66. You know,
well,
2 years,
have you seen these
50,
Boris,
something.
These Boris clients who have been, you know, and they're holding out, and they're not getting anywhere close to what they wanted.
Chapman. Look at Chapman, what he turned down from the Blue Jays. Like, if I'm Chapman, I'm firing Boris immediately. How did you not read the market?
Do you think there's something out there? Because Grambling State has made this a 3-point game now. Just under seven to go. Do you think there's something to the owners having had enough of Scott Boris and all his bullshit where they're just like, enough? You are one of the biggest problems we have in this game, and you want to have your guys hold out and sit there forever? Go right ahead, but we're not going to budge. This is our offer. You don't like it? You know, go play pickleball.
Yeah,
I mean, that's kind of what it feels like with some of these contracts. Look at Snell; didn't get anywhere near what he wanted. Signing him was a big story and I wanted no part of it. My pitching staff is already loaded with dudes who can't stay healthy. I don't need another one.
Yeah, listen, as far as, like, Scott Boris is concerned, yes, this is the owners finally sticking it to Scott Boris, because they've been burned way too many times by this guy. And the fact that he continues to call them out is another reason why he's starting to become a little bit blacklisted here. Oh, you can afford it. You can afford it. And, like, I think we've had this conversation in the group text thread before. I think we've had this conversation on, you know, baseball brunch at some point, or when we've been on this, you know, this platform before. I say it all the time. The fact that they continue to try and drive the high money teams to spend more and more and more money with the luxury tax threshold, instead of making these teams that pocket the luxury tax money every single year. And Lou, I got to include you in it.
Yeah.
But the Marlins, the Pirates, the Rays,
the Reds,
like these small market ball clubs that sit there and cry poor. But when you look at the bottom line, when Forbes puts out who makes the most money in a year, it's because the fact that the Dodgers are spending money, and the Yankees and the Phillies and the Cubs and the Red Sox, you got all these teams spending a ton of money, and it's putting money and lining it right in the pockets where these owners are not getting the money at the gate. You need to make a floor on this thing. You need to
always needed a floor.
A floor.
It's not just about a cap, it's about a floor too.
Yeah.
You gotta have both, but that floor to me is more important. You gotta make these people spend money.
They'll never agree to a cap. It's never gonna happen in baseball.
No, it won't.
So people need to stop the Fugazi thought that that's ever gonna happen.
I know.
But saying, like, hey, instead of, like, upping the percentage every year for the big money guys and saying, well, we're not gonna tax you and we're gonna punish you when you hit this threshold. How about, listen, 2025 Pirates, all you bottom feeders, you guys need to spend minimum $100 million. Then Boris is going to get what he wants. People are going to spend money, and the teams, and this is what's going to help these teams maintain a fan base to where people can believe in the ball club that's being put on the field.
Well,
instead of being martyrs for, you know, the minor league system for the big clubs. That's what they are. That's what the Marlins are. They're a breeding ground.
It's basically a 4A. They're 4A baseball team.
Yes. Yeah.
The issue, though, is that baseball, more than any other sport, gives the club the control over these players, you know, for 6 years. And then you can go to arbitration. So you can hang on to these guys for an extended period of time, unlike, you know, football, where you got to make a move. Basketball also. So obviously a lesser amount of players in basketball. But still, you give them false hope by playing off guys like Jazz or Sandy that you know that the Marlins could keep them for an X amount of period of time. And that's the false hope that fan bases like ours have. And it's terrible.
But sometimes by the time those guys are right
here in Cincinnati, I grew up in a big market area, right? I was hung up between Boston and New York, and Philly's not that far away either. So I got the Mets, the Yankees, the Red Sox, and Philadelphia all within anywhere from 40 minutes to 2 to 2.5 hours away. Nothing but big money being spent on your guys. But I'm in Cincinnati now, and I hear it all the time. And it annoys me especially here because they also like to brag about how they were the first franchise and all their – the Big Red Machine and all that stuff.
Opening day.
Nobody goes to the fucking games here. None of them. And it's got a lot to do. They all give me the same answer. Put a team together that I can be proud of and spend some money. Don't be a farm system like we're talking about, and then I'll go to games. You got to find a medium to that, right? It can't just be all one way or the other. You still have to go out and support your team if you're truly a fan. And I'll tell you what, it doesn't cost a whole lot to go to a Reds game. It just doesn't. I got tickets for Phillies at Reds April 22nd. There's a 4-game set here. So I've got my Eagles group here. A bunch of them are Phils fans too. We got about 20 of us going down. I got tickets for $48 a piece. And they're decent seats. 100 level, undercover in case it rains. Lou, you guys have both been there. You know what the sight lines are. It's a great stadium. It's a beautiful ballpark, and nobody goes.
And it's a shame. And
Castellini's a douche.
But like what Lou was saying about, like when these guys are ready to win, though, like a Sandy and a Jazz, and when they're ready to win, I know they made the postseason last year, but I'm talking about taking the next leap. That's when the Marlins ownership group is going to have to pay them big money, and then that's when they dump them. And then when they get dumped, then they bring in other prospects, and then those prospects in a year or two will join the guys that have been in the major leagues for a year or two, and they don't have enough time to gel and become a cohesive team. Like, you're trading away your leaders at that time because now it's about bottom dollar. It's about, dollars and cents. And that's the problem that stinks. For a franchise like the Marlins, who want to try and build off of something, but when they get to the bank, when it gets to the point of trying to make big money, well, they're not going to see it in Miami. The only guy that's seen it really in Miami has been Stanton, and he was gone in a couple of years.
Right, he's in the Bronx.
Yeah, the rest don't. Actually, that worked out.
Yeah. Welcome, Lou. Thank you for that. Thank you for that freaking albatross. I'm just throwing pieces.
You know who did that for you?
Yeah, Derek Jeter.
Yeah, there you go.
Jeets.
Yeah, you're never going to get me the best Jeter, though. That just won't happen.
No. Listen, man. In this city, Chase Utley can walk up to the Rocky Steps, drop his trousers, and take a crap on the Rocky Steps, and nobody will ever say a bad thing about that man of city. And he gave us one. I can only imagine what Derek Jeter could get away with in New York City.
Oh, God. And what he did get away with.
Well, yeah. Yeah.
If only gift baskets could talk.
Right. If only gift baskets could talk. That's exactly right.
Taxi money.
All right, Chris. So take us away here. What are we expecting from your fighting Phils this year?
Here's the thing. I, as Harry Callis would say, I've got high hopes about this team and the potential.
Top five
for this
roster
team
in the league.
Yeah, it's top five, no doubt about it. But there are some things that bother me already. I mean, Bryce Harper's had a back issue. They've had to shut him down towards the end of spring training here. Hopefully he's going to be back in games towards the end of the week and they can ramp him back up. But even before then, Bryce has not hit a home run yet this spring. So that kind of makes you a little bit leery, a little bit worried about what's going on. Now, he is a red light player. When the lights go on, Bryce will be ready to go come opening day. I don't like the fact that we don't have a lockdown closer in the bullpen. I don't like the closer by committee stuff. Now, obviously, I'm happy as hell that Craig Kimbrell is now in Baltimore. Have fun with that, O-Town.
You mean this guy?
Yeah. The
Karate Kid? With the crane kick?
I know they have – the Phillies have power arms in this bullpen that they've had the last couple years. And if you watch the Phillies bullpen in 2019, 2020, 2021. What Dombrowski has done with this bullpen over the last couple of years as far as putting guys that have high velocity in the back end of that bullpen. I mean, it's not just like the eighth inning guys and the ninth inning guys that can do that. The guys they bring in the sixth and seventh can tout it too, that can hit mid-90s and upper 90s with their stuff. And I love the fact that they have that, but I really wish that they had a lockdown closer in the back end of the bullpen. Again, I'm old school that way. I grew up that way. I like having one guy for the ninth inning, and that's just, I prefer to have it. So I'm hoping one of these guys
stands
out.
That was our whole life as baseball fans up until the last few years. It's always been you get to that guy. If I can turn the ball over to that guy, I take my chances every day and twice on Sunday.
Yeah, no doubt about it. And then the fact that they're going back to the well. I thought after last season in the NLCS, I thought that they would finally make a change to the lineup, and it looks like Schwarber's going to be leading off again, and I can't stand it. Mm-hmm. I understand Rob Thomson wanting to do the left-right crap. I'm sorry. The best lineup in my lifetime for the Phillies had back-to-back left-handers. You had Utley, you had Howard. Like, for me, it should be Turner, Stott, Harper, then throw one of the righties in there. I don't care. If you want JT, Castellanos, Boehm, you want them to bat clean up, great. Schwarber should be batting five.
Yeah, and I agree.
I think he would be seeing better pitches in that area of the lineup if he's batting down there. And it gives him more opportunity to drive in runs. Yeah. Like, I'd rather come out of the first inning up 5-0 instead of coming out up 1-0 because Schwarber hit a solo shot.
Or if he walks, like, what good is his walk? He is a base clogger.
Yes, in front of Trey Turner.
Front of Trey Turner, which is absolute insanity.
Over an apple.
Right. I mean, if he's batting in front of JT, I get it a little bit more, but Christ, I think even JT's faster than Schwarber is.
Yeah. But I will say this. I mean, the expectation, the Phillies are going to make the playoffs. It's just, I think that the Phillies, if they get off to a good start this year, as compared to the last couple of years, I think they're going to run with the Braves for division this year. I mean, the last couple of years, the Braves have been 14 games up on them when the season's ended, and the Phillies got their number in the playoffs. However, I don't see the Braves being as good this year. First of all, the offense last year was historic. They can't do that again. And you can't run it back, and you can't do that all over again. They're going to have issues there at some point along the line. They're not going to be running, having this historic offense from start to finish like they did last year. And then I look at their starting pitching staff. Charlie Morton is a year older. Chris Sale, nice trade. Nice trade if it's 7 years ago.
Right.
I mean, the guy is turning 35, 36 this year and has not pitched a complete season in Major League Baseball since 2018.
I'd like to know when the last time he actually finished a game.
You're talking complete game?
Chris Sale. When did he not have to get pulled off the mound?
Yeah.
The velo's still there on Sale. He's still, he's still coming with it. Is he going to stay healthy? I agree with you. He's probably not. But
ask any Red Sox fan how they feel about Chris Sale, dude. I mean, every comment I would get, hashtag Sale Day. Oh, how I love throwing that back in their face.
Oh, dude. But also their starting pitching depth too behind that. I mean, Kyle Wright is going to be out all season after shoulder surgery. I mean, that guy won you 20 games 2 years ago. So he's going to be missing. Bryce Edler, can he do what he did last year? They're going to be relying on some younger guys. Max Fried had some injuries last year. And a lot of times when a lefty starts experiencing those injuries, it starts to snowball. So I look at the Phillies can run with this division. However, I'm a little disappointed, and I know every Phillies fan is, with how the season ended last year. Sure. And a lot of times when a season ends in disappointment like that one does, I don't like how things line up the following year, because a lot of times with a baseball season and sports in general, the fun part is the journey.
Yeah.
And that's game one to game 162 to get yourself to the postseason. I'm a little worried with the mindset of this team going into the season and sitting there. It's kind of like the Sixers the last few years. They've been chasing their tails to get to the second round because they want to prove that they can get past that.
Right.
I think that's where the Phillies are at right now. They're starting to get frustrated with the results the last couple of years. They know they should have won the World Series last year. They know
that. It's a squandered opportunity.
Yes.
Absolutely.
We played with the house money the year before. Yeah. We were up 2-1 in that series, but the Astros were the better team.
Yeah, they were.
They should have won the World Series last year. There's no doubt in anybody's minds. And it's like with the Eagles, how they blew the Super Bowl last year. Up 10 at halftime, becoming the second team ever to blow a double-digit halftime lead. And what happened this year? Nothing was fun. Nothing was fun for the players. Nothing was fun for the fan base because they knew they blew it. And then the end of the season was –
they had a couple of garbage coordinators come in.
Yeah. And then the end of the season is a travesty. Uh-huh. I'm a little bit worried of the mindset of the team. They're saying all the right things. They're doing all the right things. It's a big difference when you get into the season and acting upon it. They need to get off to a fast start. That is key this year. You cannot get behind the eight ball heading into early June.
No, that's been a problem the last 2 years, right?
Yeah.
Two years ago, you were, okay, let's fire Girardi. And it sparked them.
Yeah.
Last year, you were not going to fire Rob. So you're going to have to go find that fire somewhere else.
Yeah.
You cannot come out this year and, you know, be flopping around, you know, 20 and 22, you know, when you get to that quarter way point
22 and 28, 22 and 30. I mean, that's where we've been the last 2 years getting into June. And it's not going to cut it this year. And these guys have to start out fresh. There's no excuse this year. Last year, Suarez was hurt coming out of the WBC. You know, Trey Turner was getting used to a new town. I don't want to hear that bullshit this year. I don't want to hear it at all.
I was disappointed in Trey Turner starting off the year last year. I mean, he had that huge WBC. I'm like, everyone was running around calling him Captain America.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And rightfully so. He was enormous in that WBC. And I just thought, man, and I was pissed when you guys signed him. Fuck, man, God, I wanted that kid in pinstripes. And then he just, like, he had to – and for – look, dude – I don't know what's going on in Philly, but for the Philly crowd to try to will him back by giving him a standing O,
don't do
that
it.
That was different, dude.
I'm telling you, that was the happiest I've ever been not being around here.
Couldn't even imagine,
bro. It was on Sports Talk Radio that Wednesday and Thursday, and I was flying out with my dad and my best friend on Friday morning to Minnesota to see the Twins and the Diamondbacks that night. And I just remember, like, those couple days, I'm like, I cannot wait to get away from here. Because, like, that's not Philadelphia. That's not what we do.
It's really not.
No, this is not participation trophy town.
No.
And then when the Eagles were going through their spell, I had to listen to it again. Well, maybe we need to give them a standing. No, you boo the shit out of that team. Like, if you're playing like crap, you need to be booed. I don't care about effort. Effort is what it is, you know. But if you're playing like crap, I'm going to let you hear it.
And I got it with Judge. He had that huge year, right? And yeah, the breaking Maris's record thing. And then he scuffled a little bit last year before the injury.
Injuries, the toe.
But, I mean, even before that, you know, he's going through a little bit of and the crowd starts booing him. And he's all this freaking message boards and shit light up. And even friends of mine who I've known for a long time text me, how could they possibly boo Aaron Judge? I'm like, time out, dude. This crowd booed Mickey Mantle. If Mickey Mantle can get booed, everyone is free game. Everyone, right? Derek Jeter opened up a year like 0 for 31. I forget what the hell. It was something awful. And he was getting booed. He's the king of New York. It's Derek Jeter. You're trying to tell me Aaron Judge can't get booed? Get the fuck out of here, dude. I get to know.
Here's the best example of all time, and I'll wrap up on the Phillies, okay? Lou being football fan, obviously, and Adam being an Eagles fan, the night the Eagles hung the Super Bowl banner, and they came out and they played like crap in the first half.
Yep.
And what happened as they were going into the tunnel at halftime? They got booed off the field.
Let them have it, bro.
The defending Super Bowl champions are running off the field in their house the night the first Super Bowl banner got hung in
first the night. Super, that's the biggest part. The first time ever that we're hanging a Super Bowl banner. And you're getting booed mercilessly off the field.
I remember talking to my wife leading into that season. And I'm like,
who was the opponent that night?
Oh, they were playing Atlanta.
Atlanta.
Yeah. And I'm sitting there, I'm talking to her. I'm like, I worry about, as a fan base and myself included, do we still have it? Like, are we going to be soft this year? Cause I don't want to be soft. I want another one. I want to do it again. And then the next thing you know, they're booing them off the head. And I'm, I had a couple pops in me at that time. And And I'm like, we still got it.
Yeah.
We still got it.
Well, New York has a Bronx cheer, and I guess Philly has the what'd you call it? What is it?
The Philly boo the shit out of them. That's
There's nothing quite like the, getting booed in Philadelphia. Oh, no. Way worse than anywhere else.
Way worse. Hit you with an occasional battery just to wake you up a little more.
Well, we did that one time.
There's been rumors of knives being thrown from the right field bleachers at time. You know, shit happens.
Which is way worse than throw. I was at that game, by the way, where they threw the D batteries at JD Drew. I did not throw. I was only like 13 or 14 at the time. So, I wouldn't even know what the hell to do with that. But I was there when that happened. I was ashamed.
All right, so where are the Phils finishing this year, bud? What do you got? Well, NL East is going to come down to Atlanta and Philadelphia.
As much as I worry, my predictions, which I did on a show with John Jansen on The Gambler.
Yep.
What was that? Right before I went to Mexico. So that was about a month ago. I had the Phillies win the division. Well, I think the Phillies are going to win the East for the first time since 2011. I think the Braves run along the top. I think the Braves are still going to make the playoffs. I mean, the Braves are too good. They're going to make the playoffs. So I'm not saying that they're going to completely fall off. But I think this is the year that the Phillies get the job done with the division. They get a first-round bye. I want to get out of that wild-card round, which is just complete chaos. I love it. But, my God, a three-game series is nuts.
That's rough, dude.
Yeah.
That is rough.
Yeah. So I got the Phillies winning the East and losing to the Orioles in the World Series.
Losing to the Orioles. So you think the Orioles are going to repeat the magic they had last year?
I think the Orioles are built for the long haul. I've told you this before.
They're young.
The Orioles are built for the next 5 to 7 years with that core, a new
ownership. Well, now new ownership.
Yeah.
I think that's a huge, huge deal.
They got a number one in Burns. Yep. I mean, that's huge. Yeah. And you got a guy in Adley Rutschman, and I'll get to it later if we do our predictions. A guy that reminds me of a Buster Posey, you know, could come in, be that catcher that ties the whole team together, you know, and leads them into the postseason like that Giants team did long ago.
I still got the bobblehead sitting right over here.
Right.
The Rushman bobblehead traded you the ring for it.
Both of them are right on my nightstand next to my bed. Lou's going to dive into the Marlins next. I have to bring this up because I saw Ash repost this on X or Twitter, whatever the hell it is. I still call it Twitter. But, dude, I'm telling you, I'm in this close to coming down to Miami and visiting you once more because the $52 all-you-can-eat seat, holy hell, that looks fantastic. Yeah. And all the weight that I've lost over the last 2 years, and I mean, it's like 15 pounds of, like, you know, but I do my workouts all the time. Adam knows I hopped on after my Peloton workout last week for the Right on Cue show. But, but man, I'm telling you, that $52, like, if that doesn't pack the stands, I don't know what will.
$52 all you can eat?
Yep.
Ooh, I am uniquely shaped to enjoy the shit out of that.
Well, listen. Chris will put you on his Peloton, put some wheels on that thing. Both of you guys come down.
I may have to jog back here from Miami to drop all the weight back off. But you know, $52 for all you can eat.
That's what.
So what does it include? Though, is it just dogs and shit, or is it
everything? Dogs,
everything.
Not burgers though, because we got a special Jake Burger promotion, so it can't include a burger. But pretty much everything else you want. And you saw it, Chris. I mean, dangerous. I had a whole
layout. Oh, my God.
Yeah.
I know here in Cincinnati, I could have upped it to $90 a ticket, and it would have gotten us into the Bally Sports Club, which has an all-you-can-eat buffet.
Wow.
Yeah, $90. Right. And you get to go into a club seat.
Yo! Like,
if it starts raining or if it's cold and shit, you just got to sit inside, smash, and watch the game from the window.
Yeah, a lot of times it just depends on how many – people are going to spend $90 on a ticket, which is funny because they still wind up spending that much money between beer and food and all that crap anyway. So,
well, that's just it. I mean, I went with the $48 seats for our group just because it's a group. I mean, there's 20 of us. I didn't want anybody feeling some kind of way like they had, like, we're only doing $90 seats. Like, we all want to sit together and make it as easy as possible $48. You're going to spend $20 on parking. And, you know, it's a Monday night, so people are probably not getting too torn up. This was their choice, by the way, for the game. The Phillies come here. They play a four-game set, Monday through Thursday. The Thursday game is your businessman special. I'm like, why don't we just all take a half a day from work and go to that? Daytime, it's going to be a little bit warmer. It is April here in Cincinnati. You're not quite sure what kind of weather you're going to get. They all wanted to go to the Monday night game. I'm like, all right. $48. I'll meet you there.
Yeah, they leave Cincinnati and they go straight to San Diego. And me and Rich will be out there that weekend.
Oh, you're going for that one. That's your jam this year?
Well, that's the first one. We'll dive more into it.
Yeah, we'll get into that.
But yeah, we'll talk more about that.
All right, Lou. So you heard his predictions on your NL East. You're in the same division.
Yep.
I tend to agree with Chris. I think the Braves and the Phillies to me is like a flip a coin. They're both extraordinarily talented. I like that Phillies team, though. They're really fun to watch. Where do the Marlins play in all this?
I'll make this brief because I'm not expecting much. We're coming off a wild card. You know, we went down to Chris's Phillies. You would think that would bring optimism, but we let our big bat go. Jorge Soler didn't come back. We signed Tim Anderson, which, you know, he's coming off his worst career year ever.
He got knocked the frig out.
Right. He got his head knocked off. Let's not forget that one.
Right. Cross took it to him and down goes Anderson. But yeah, man. I mean, you know, top of the order isn't bad. You got Louis Arise, right? So last year, for the better part of the beginning of the season, he's in the 400 chase. You know, he's batting 375, 380. There's a shot. I know there's a lot more to do after that, but he was in that race. People were talking about it, brought people to the ballpark. You know, there was a buzz every time he came up to bat. We made some trades for Bell and Berger, as we mentioned, two guys that can hit the ball out of the ballpark. Jazz, can he stay healthy? I mean, he really hasn't proven he can do that. He's an electric player when he's out there, but he's just missed so much time over his brief career so far. And so it's tough to count on him. If he is healthy, we got something. But the lineup, bottom part of the lineup is just pathetic. I mean, Avisel Garcia, a guy that we got a couple years ago from Milwaukee, has been a horrible signing, maybe the worst signing we've ever done. And that includes Giancarlo Stanton. Sorry. But he's your problem now, Adam. But yeah, no, Avisel Garcia has been horrible. And then the biggest the biggest issue is our starting unit. I mean, not just our Cy Young winner, Sandy Alcantara, gone for the year through Tommy John. You got Edward Cabrera out with a shoulder issue. Yuri Perez, who actually we saw in Cincinnati, Adam, when I was out there, me and Ash were out there. He's now having problems with his elbow, and same kind of deal with as Cole's been coming out here. We don't know when the timeline is for him to get back on the mound. And then, you know, we also Braxton Garrett is a guy that started last year. So we're down four starters from what we finished with last year. And then Max Meyer, who was a heralded prospect coming back from Tommy John, he's going to start the season in the minors, you know, just to build his arm strength up. And then a guy that you know, Chris, a guy that is responsible for putting your catcher, Sixto Sanchez. I mean, here's a guy that he started actually our playoff game back in the COVID year 2020, and he has not been able to make a start in the big league since then. And that's also going to go down as one of the worst trades in Marlin history, and there's a lot of them.
I just want to ask real quick because I saw a recent picture of Sixto.
It's Bartolo Colon.
Yeah, well, I was about to ask, did they, like, test the $52 all-you-can-eat
stuff? I think Sixto.
It's like hair club for men, right? Not only a pitcher, I'm also a fan. Stuffing freaking hot dogs in his face.
Man, that picture, I mean, for Marlins Twitter or X, it went viral as much as it could be, but everybody was saying, are you sure that's not Bartolo Colon out there? Because, man. Sixto definitely was eating his way through the offseason.
Yeah,
kind of reminded me of the Derek Eater New York Post, the one time with Derek Jeter. Remember that picture of him in the offseason? He had like the walking boot.
Yeah.
Like, really Derek Eater. Let himself go.
Yeah. I love the people that try to say, because, you know, Jeets plays his pretty much his whole career. Well, a good portion of it, you know, when you had all the steroid shit going on, right? Well, Jeter must have done steroids.
Yeah.
Jeter's 6'3", weighs 190 pounds, soaking wet with pockets full of rocks, dude. Like, this is not a guy that did juice. At least I want to believe that.
There's a lot of times where, you know, we've talked about it ourselves, amongst ourselves and whatnot, but I think it's like it's a topic of conversation with baseball fans alike. You know, who's the greatest player that you've ever seen live and in person? Jeter's always one of the top five guys that I would say. I mean, you know, as far as like position players are concerned, I mean, seeing Mariano Rivera come in and, you know, put the iron fist down in a ninth inning in a World Series at Citizens Bank Park. I've witnessed that firsthand.
Did you ever see him come into a game at the Bronx?
I did, and he blew the game. It was
stay out of my ballpark, damn it.
So 2013 was Mo's last year, right? Or was that?
Yes. 2013 was, yeah.
And then 2014. Yeah. So 2013, me and Rach had just got engaged, and I helped out the regional manager up in Bayonne, New Jersey. I helped out him with his new office administrator at the time. And he's a big Yankee fan, half season ticket holder. So he's like, hey, I'm going to send you a list of Yankee games. Tell me which ones you want. You can have them. So I was like, all right, cool. So I took three games. I took one on a Sunday against the Orioles, one on a Sunday against the Rays, and then like a midweek game against the Angels. Because I never saw Mike Trout in person at that time.
Oh, there you go.
Yeah. I didn't make it to that game because, you know, the dispatcher at the time got fired and had started my promotion cycle. So I can't complain. but me and Rach went to an Orioles game, and Mo came in the ninth inning, and it was awesome. Yeah, Enter Sandman and all that stuff. And he gave up a home run in that ninth inning and wound up blowing the game. The Rays game was better because Jeets came back in that game from an injury. And it was in his first at bat, first pitch, he hit a home run to right center field, which was awesome. It was like, oh, the place went nuts.
Oh, yeah.
But yeah, old Yankee Stadium is still better than New Yankee Stadium. It's
not there's no question about it. Yeah, there's no question. Just the noise level alone, dude. Oh. You can hear it on the TV. If you've ever been to both, the old stadium, it would get to where you couldn't hear the announcers. When you'd get like those big, huge playoff games, especially at, like 1996, I never heard noise quite like that because it had been a while. You know what I mean? And the noise, because the way the stadium was built. Lou, did you ever go to old Yankee Stadium?
I did not, and I haven't been to the new one either.
So new Yankee Stadium is built it's built much like your modern ballparks, right, where the seats are kind of set back and there's really no bad views pretty much anywhere. Old Yankee Stadium, you were up like right over the field, it felt like, in a lot of the ballparks. So that noise, when that place would get rocking, and it would just echo throughout the whole place, dude. I literally, sitting in the right field bleachers, could feel the place shaking. The ALCS that we blew against the Red Sox was game two against Pedro. And that was the Who's Your Daddy, when the whole crowd is chanting Who's Your Daddy. And the stadium organist starts feeding into it. They played a dun, 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 and it's supposed to say, like, the scoreboards are all saying, let's go Yankees. The whole crowd, Who's Your Daddy? And I mean, that place literally shaking. The bleachers and everything were shaking. Not from people stomping on them. Everyone was up on their feet. It was out of control. The noise that would come out of that place was – the only thing I've seen modern-wise that compares to it is the bank. That place gets fucking loud, dude. We were there in July, right? Now, granted, it was against the Padres, NLCS rematch. Some hype going on. We got to our seat right as the kid center fielder made that huge play. It was like his first start. Yeah.
Rojas.
Yeah, Rojas. He makes that play and center turns around and hoses it back to the infield and nails the guy at first. And this is July. Nobody. This is the first inning. Not everybody's at their seat yet. And Grady turns to me, Dad, why is it so loud? I looked at him. I said, welcome to Philadelphia, dude. It's that level of volume. I couldn't imagine what it's like being there for a playoff game.
Yeah, I mean, playoffs is nuts. It's been revitalized the last 2 years, and I say it all the time. I mean, in my lifetime, I was born in '86. So, and listen, the Phillies haven't made the playoffs, you know, all that frequently during the course of my lifetime. But I've missed one postseason series in my lifetime, and that was the '93 World Series. My dad brought me in '92 NLCS or '93 NLCS. 07, 08, 09, 10, 11. I was at every single round. Haven't been at every single game, but I've been at every single round.
Every single round, yeah.
Yeah, that's the reason why it was important to go to St. Louis a couple years ago and go to St. Louis, because I can say that I've been at every single one except for the 93 World Series. Right. And I'll tell you, man, like that run, those 5 years, that place was loud. And there was I was at a lot of great games. Saw him clinch the pennant 09, Shane slam off of Sabathia, you know, going to Roy Halladay's postseason no-hitter. A lot of great moments during the course of that stretch. I never have heard anything closest. Like, probably the closest thing that I will say as far as, like, being loud was when Claude Giroux scored the overtime winner in Game 3 of the 2010 Stanley Cup Finals. I mean, that was
the first closed arena.
Yeah, and that was the first time the Flyers have won a Stanley Cup Final game since 1987. So it was just nuts. But 45,000 fans at the bank.
Open air.
There's nothing. There's nothing like it. It's an addiction. You have to feel it.
I've only been there twice, two day games, and one of them against the Marlins. So didn't really get the appreciation for it. But obviously seeing them over the years in the playoffs and hearing that on TV and specifically during our series where we actually watched it. Ash and I watched it at Lone Depot Park, and they had the sound blasting, and you could hear how loud it was in there. And I also want to throw in two Yankee Stadium memories, even though I'd never been. I'll give you a good one and a bad one, Adam. One you're going to like, one you're not going to like. 2003 World Series, where Josh Beckett, complete game shutout in Game 6.
Actually, Sonic rounds out right back to him to close it out. I know.
Closed down Yankee Stadium, last World Series game there. But look, I'll give you another one 2 years prior to that, 2001. I won't forget, against the Diamondbacks. They had a 3-1 lead, the Diamondbacks did. Is that right?
They were up 2-0.
No, they were up 2-0 going to Yankee Stadium.
And they won the 3
at home.
Correct. Yeah. So after Game 4, Byung-Young Kim, I think it was, who blew two games in a row.
Yeah, we call him Hang One High.
But, you know, in the locker room, they were giving all the Diamondbacks relievers, specifically him, the business. And I forget who it was. I don't know if it was Mark Grace or somebody said, a reporter said, what about the mystique and the aura of Yankee Stadium? And he said, mystique and the aura? Yeah. Sounds like two strippers. And then somebody had a sign out in center field that said, mystique and aura performing nightly. It was just nuts, those three games against the Diamondbacks. And
we had no business winning those three. No. The team didn't hit worth a shit until it got to the ninth inning.
Yeah.
You know, Tino ties it up with that big three-run homer. Brosius just walks one off. Jeter does his Mr. November thing.
Yep.
Right, this is just after 9/11. It was the first time that the World Series went into November. So the clock strikes midnight, and here's Jeter. Of course, you know, talk about a guy that doesn't shy away from bright lights. Yeah, there's Jeter, smack. You know, okay, well, I say smack, but let's be honest, it fucking popped it over the right field wall. You know? Yeah, right. Which is where my concern is with Juan Soto. You guys have seen a number of left-handed hitters who are supposed to be big guys. Even Jason Giambi when he came over, and they come to Yankee Stadium and they see that short porch and they start getting pull happy. Right, everyone gets pull happy when they left at Yankee Stadium. Well, I worry about Soto like that.
This is a good segue for you.
Yeah.
So Lou, what's your expectation?
Yeah. What is your expectation for the month?
It's just you can't overcome missing four starters. You can't. So and it's off out of the gate. You know, if it happens midseason, you got some kind of a cushion. I could see it, but I don't see how we can recover from that. I see us finishing in last place. I hate to say it, but I see us finishing last. I think the Mets will finish in fourth. I like the Nationals. The Nationals are a young team. I like Abrams. I like Lane Thomas. They got two good starters up front, a decent bullpen. So I think the Nationals are going to be sneaky good this year. They're not going to challenge, but they'll finish coming third. I disagree with you, though, with the Braves, though. I think the Braves, that lineup is potent. Unlike you guys with Castellano, you know, he's proven he could do it, but has he proven he could do it for a whole year? I haven't seen it. And so I just think the Braves lineup, top to bottom, stands out a little more. Strider, I'd have to give it to him. He's maybe the second best pitcher in the league right now. So I'm going to favor the Braves to win that division.
But you got the Phillies making the playoffs, though.
Oh, yeah. I got the Phillies. I got the Phillies coming in second and making the playoffs. But, yeah, I do got Atlanta winning the division.
All right. So there you heard it. So at the top, we got Phillies, Braves with – what was the rest of the division for you? So you got Phil's, Braves.
I actually kind of agree with Lou. I think the Nationals are sneaky good.
So it's Nationals, Mets, Marlins?
Yeah, I don't want to put – for Lou's sake, I don't want to put the Marlins in the basement. But the starting pitching is – you have to worry about that. Yeah,
of course.
Especially if you're going to be throwing kids out there. You know you're going to have kid gloves on them anyway.
Yep. And you're going to play those two lineups, the Phillies and the Braves, a total of how many times during the regular season?
Not as much as you used to. 12 no, times yeah. now?
Well, it's 12 times. So times. Yeah. 24 of your games are against two of the most lethal lineups in the league with a very beleaguered pitching staff. Yeah, it's going to be tough. Yep.
Yeah.
Chris, I did want to say sorry about the Mets, though. Let's talk Mets here. They've already said, no, No, because look, you got guys like Lindor, Marte, you know, and they've already said that they're in a rebuilding process. So how quick of a trigger finger are they going to have to pull to get rid of those guys and ship them off to somebody else? Because Lindor can still play. Marte's quick. You know, Alonso, I mean, how long are they going to go with this lineup of big loaded players that, you know, that they're going to quit? They've already announced that they're
going to. I'm surprised that Marte hasn't been traded already, or at least bought out and sent packing through waivers. He's been a big disappointment. And that was a big sticking point of why I didn't want Marte to begin with. Everyone's like, oh, speedy center fielder, you know, bring him in. Now, let the Mets spend a 4-year deal on that. I don't want to touch that at all. Yeah. The big piece that's going to be huge at the trade deadline for the Mets is going to be Alonso. It's his walk year. His contract year, he's probably going to be the biggest bat available at the trade deadline. And for the Mets, that's going to be huge for them because they're going to be able to command high-level prospects. Even though he's going to be a rental, they're still going to be able to get a good payday out of him. Now, what teams are going to be pining for a first base or a DH at that moment in time? It's going to remain to be seen. We'll see.
Well, fits fine on my roster. We got a collection of those guys.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, he probably would, I mean, especially because this is a one year for Rizzo. I don't like him either. I think he's a giant tool.
Yeah.
Which, you know, he fits the Mets mold perfectly.
Yeah.
But trading Lindor, did Lindor win the Silver Slugger last year? Or is it just a gold glove at shortstop?
Let me pull up his gold glove.
Look it up.
I'm going to pull up his page now.
I mean, he could still fetch you a decent return, but they're going to have to do what they did with Verlander and Scherzer. They're going to have to eat a lot of the money to get better prospects because that's still a longer term deal. I think that's got about, 4 or 5 years left on it, minimum? I mean, like, he's played well when he's been healthy, but he's been a big disappointment on that contract.
So Lindor did not win the Gold Glove last year. He did win Silver Slugger.
Okay. Yeah. All right.
I mean, you know, it – 254 batting average, but 31 homers, 98 RBIs, 31 stolen bases.
Yeah. How many years are left on that contract, Adam?
Let's see here. We go to Spotrac. Where the fuck is it? So he signs a 10-year, $341 million deal.
5 years, 5 or 6 years left probably, right?
He's got 1 month left, dude. It runs through 2031.
Good God. Seven years left.
And it is right down the board, 32 mil every year. There's no variable.
He's not going anywhere. He's not going anywhere. He's going to wallow away in Queens.
And so think about it. At 32 million a year for the next 7 years, he's 30 this year.
I mean, that's what contracts run now. I mean, they run in the late 30s.
They all want to get to that age 40 season. You saw a run of it, right? Yeah. Harper did it. Turner did it. Yeah. Judge did it. They all want to get – Ohtani, same thing. They all want to get to that age 40 season. I think it's a little nuts, but in some cases, what are you supposed to do, right? Like the Phillies needed to go out and get their guy. I actually thought at the time that they signed – that the deal was so good for Philadelphia – I thought there was a chance you were going to go get Mike Trout, too. I thought that contract to Harper left enough room to bring in Trout if he wanted to.
He became a free agent. The problem was, like, two weeks later, he signed his extension with the Angels.
Yeah.
I know Quimby gets upset about that. When they're like, oh, man, well, he should have came home. Like, the Angels drafted him. I mean, they – you know, I appreciate loyalty. You know, like, I think if it's being reciprocated to you – you should give it right back. And I have no problem with that. Listen, he's probably going to wallow away the rest of his career with the Angels.
It's a shame.
And they're going to suck. And yeah, it's a shame. And he's probably only going to play in three postseason games in his whole entire career, which they got swept. But it's just like the greatest player of the last 10 years. And this is like, you know, we're talking with Diaz about this. And, you know, like when he wants to talk about like Claude Giroux, but, you know, Claude Giroux played in a final, you know, Embiid's never even sniffed in the Eastern Conference final. Diaz, by the way. But like, you can't sit there and put all the problems on the star player. Like, it's like,
no.
You kind of,
no, in particular, not baseball, when your owner has basically prints his own money. There's really no excuse for the Angels to have been as bad as they've been.
And I got
to
tell you,
it's not like they've not gone out and tried to get other guys. They bring in Pujols. Right.
They brought in the wrong ones. Rendon.
They brought in a run. That might be the worst contract in baseball, dude.
Rendon is
history.
Awful.
History.
Yeah.
History. There's no deal that's worse than that deal.
So ever. Bad.
Really bad. Really bad.
All the way around.
It's not that important to him. Like,
then you hear
it before you sign the contract.
He's out there one preaching. We should only play 120 games or something. Yeah. Well, of course you want the season short. You can't stay on the field for a whole season. Exactly. You jerk off.
He can't do it for 6 years.
Who cares? You're too busy choking Oakland fans.
Yeah. He doesn't care. He's a total jerk. And then the opposite of that is a guy like Trout, who, I got to tell you, went out to Angel Stadium in 2019. Ash and I went this past year. Trout was injured. But in 2019, when I first saw him, it was a known thing that he is left field, go down there, and there's a line of people there. He'll sign for everybody. And just couldn't be a nicer guy. Signed everybody's balls. Must have been signing for about 45 minutes. No business needing to do that. And he just gives it back to the game. You know, it's a shame. It's a shame that he can't win a playoff series, you know, much less get to the playoffs. So it's tough.
I appreciate the loyalty, too. I like seeing guys stay with the team for their whole career, a la Derek Jeter, a la, you know, a lot. I mean, there's been not so much now, but there used to be, right?
Right.
Is there a part of it with Trout where you look at him like, is it all loyalty or are you just kind of a chicken shit?
No, I don't think it's that. He was
going to get that money no matter where he went.
Yeah, that's true. He probably would have got more.
He might have got more
market.
Yeah,
but he probably also saw, like, listen, when you're in an organization and you're growing up in that organization, you tend to make relationships and friendships with the people that are running that organization. And maybe it's selling you a bill of goods, but you believe in what they're telling you and what they're selling you. Listen, I think at some point along the line, the Angels and him are probably going to have to come to an agreement where, you know, he's probably going to have to go elsewhere. How do you move that contract, especially the fact that he has not been healthy now since, what, 2019?
It's been a number of years now, dude.
Yeah. 2019. Yeah. I think 2019 was maybe his last full season. He wasn't completely healthy in 2018. You know, it's been a while. He's still a great player when he's healthy. But when your body starts breaking down, it's a lot like Ken Griffey Jr. He was such a great player.
The legs went out.
His legs just started to go, and that took away all his athleticism, and he was shot from there. And if you look at Trout's stats so far this spring, they ain't good.
No. Right. So 2016, he plays 159 games. He has not played more than 140 since then.
Yeah. 2017, he tore like a ligament in his thumb. It was kind of like a fluke injury. I remember that one because I went to Boston for a bachelor party. good times.
Good times.
I hate everything Boston stands for as far as their sports, but good God, that it really is a fun city.
It is.
It is.
Yeah.
Great. I would say, look, with Trout, I don't think he's scared to go somewhere else or he's not going to do well in a big market should it come to that. You know, we saw him in the WBC last year where he faced, at the time, his former teammate Otani, last pitch of the game for the championship. He was a big star for Team USA. He obviously plays well when he's in big, you know, he's had good success playing in New York and stuff. So I don't think it's going to be a problem where he can't adjust to a bigger market or, you know, a fan base that's rabid, you know. So I think he'll be fine. It's just, like you said, it's him not being able to stay on the field and, you know, wears on you not being able to play in the postseason. Manley went through that for forever with the Yankees prior to them extending the playoffs by a round and adding the wild card. But you feel for guys like that, that, you know, really, have the stats and play season after season. They just can't get to October, deep in October.
It was 94, dude. 94 is the one that breaks your heart. I mean, 95 was bad enough the way it ended. Because, I mean, the loss was – it angered you.
Yeah.
But you knew that was it for Donnie, right?
Yeah.
Everyone knew it. This was it. So, I mean, it was just gut-wrenching. But 94 is the one where it was like – and then a strike happens. You know, and it just like, God damn it, man. Madden was finally going to get there. We were – you know, we were the best team in the American League that year. And now, look, if it's us in the Expos in the series, I don't know. I'm not going to sit here and tell you we were going to beat the Expos, bro. That team was freaking loaded.
When's that documentary coming out, man? I cannot wait, man.
Yeah,
those,
I know it, right?
Those Expos teams, specifically the 94 team. Wow.
Oh, God, they were so deep.
Yeah. The
team was loaded. But, you know, Mike Trout, so when you go to, like, the baseball reference stuff, first you look at all the bold numbers, right? There's not a single one from 2020 – forward for him.
It's the climb.
Not a single one.
Yeah.
And he's only he's 32 years old this year.
Yep.
So
I got some milestones. I don't know if you want to run through them. You got to give your Yankee prediction.
We need to talk Yankees.
Yes.
Hold on.
What are you comfortable? Have at it, kid.
All right, dude. So I would like for – and none of my friends will answer this question because I just don't want to admit it. I myself am an honest Yankee fan. I might be the most honest Yankee fan out there.
And we appreciate that.
I don't do the whole – you know, look, you push me too far, I'm just going to tell you 27 rings, go fuck yourself. If you're just an ignorant fan.
But you always do that argument, by the way.
Right. It's just no – it's like, oh, you weren't even born yet. I don't give a shit. I still got five in my lifetime, so fuck you. You know what I mean? But the one question I've got, I don't even need to talk about the pitching staff. When you take Gerrit Cole off of that, just look at the names on that pitching staff. Rodon, Stroman. It's just like
Stroman refusing opening day.
Refusing opening day. And it's okay. Dude, why is that even acceptable?
Wow.
I mean, just look at the starting rotation. There's Nestor Cortez, Carlos Rodon, Marcus Stroman, Clark Schmidt. And, you know, possibly there's whoever, what's his name? Will Warren.
Clark W. Griswold?
Dude, it was already, to me, Cole and let's hope some of these guys stay together. Now Cole's gone. So the whole pitching staff is just a disaster. You got your relievers. Clay Holmes is supposed to be the closer. You know, we'll see if he can find his brain again.
It cost me some money a couple years ago, bastard.
Jonathan Lasagna, that we like to call him, Lewisica. You know, we got decent guys in the bullpen. What's going to happen? The starters are going to go four innings. A lot. And that bullpen is going to get wiped out early. And then the wheels are going to come off. But my bigger question is, where is my offense coming from? If I don't get it from Judge and Soto, where's it coming from? Who is my guy? Gleyber Torres in a contract year? All right, maybe. You know, I guess I can see it, but he's the epitome of inconsistency. You get to the end of the year, you're like, oh, he didn't have a bad year. But when you watch it throughout the season, it's a fucking disaster. He's up, down, left, right. Shortstop, Volpe, second year. You know, I need the homers to come down. I need the contact to go up. We need to get a better strikeout to walk ratio. I don't want a .283 on base percentage out of a guy who can be a base stealer.
To be fair, he'll probably have more hair on his chest this season.
Right.
He might actually be shaving this year.
There you go.
Well, and side note, I'm one of the Yankee fans that I'm telling they need to back off the whole no shave. You got to be all clean cut, shaved, all that.
Yeah.
And we let these guys be dudes already. Come on.
Yeah, it's over. It's done.
Over, right?
It's done.
Anthony Rizzo at first base. So, you know, he's looked decent in the spring. Maybe that post-concussion stuff is gone, but he'll be 35 years old in August. He's not the hitter he once was.
He's a great dude, though. He's a guy
he's a great, for. He's a great locker room guy, and he's really tight with Judge. And I love Anthony Rizzo. I love his attitude. I love the fact that he doesn't wear batting gloves. And his defense is not going to go away, right? Like his defense, you can't teach that.
Moises Alou didn't wear batting gloves either. He just peed on his hands.
He just peed on his hands. So did Jorge Posada and Vladimir Guerrero.
Oh, I didn't know Posada did.
Oh, yeah.
Oh.
Just soak, soak their hands in piss.
Like when they hit a home run, do you high five them or you just give them the?
Oh yeah, elbow touch.
You gotta dab them, right? Like, got it, dude.
Sorry, like, continue the rant.
If I don't get it from Judge and Soto, and I do worry about Soto, he's also in a contract here. I love the fact that of what he could do, what he's done throughout his short career so far. But I don't like making that trade without knowing that I could go and re-sign him.
Yeah. And can
so
you
now you gave away the pieces. Now he's here. What happened? Now Garrett Cole's hurt. What happens if Judge gets hurt and his team just goes completely into the shitter? Soto's not sticking around, especially with the way that media is going to be all up everyone's ass. And he's not going to have anyone like a Cole or a Judge to kind of shield him from some of that. He won't stay. And I do worry about him getting pull happy looking at that short porch in right field. They all freaking do it. Teixeira did it. Giambi did it. Not realizing that it is that short and these guys can just take their natural swing and get what they need out of it. Then you talk about Judge with the health. Let's not act like that hasn't been a thing. Outside of a couple of seasons, it's been a thing. And where is he going to play this year?
He's center field.
Center field, which one diminishes your outfield defense because he is a far superior right fielder than he is the center fielder. I commend his athletic ability, a guy his size, for being able to play center field, but he doesn't have the range of your prototypical center fielder. And now you're weakening right field because that's where you're going to have to put Soto at Yankee Stadium. You can't put Soto in left field at Yankee Stadium. It's too goddamn deep. You have to put Verdugo over there. So is Judge going to stay healthy? I already lost Garrett Cole. I don't think Cole's coming back this year. I think that's got Tommy John surgery written all over it.
That's how they normally end up.
Yeah, and I wish if it's going to happen, just do it now. Get it the fuck over with. Yep. We'll see you in a year, right? It's March. Get it over with now. You're back and ready for the start of next year. You want to try to hem and haw and, you know, avoid surgery until when? June? And then have it anyways? Now I don't – not only do I lose you for the rest of this year, I lose you for half of next year too. On that big-ass freaking $324 million contract.
With nobody else that really saddles up with him at the top of that rotation.
Nobody.
Yeah.
Nobody. It was Cole and pray that Nestor Cortez, who you could have seen his injuries coming last year with the innings he had the year before that he had never thrown before. That was obvious. You got Cortez, Rodon, who's been good when he's been healthy, which is fucking never. Yeah. It's like Cole and then a bunch of number 3 to 5 starters. I don't have a number 2, right? When you take Cole out of that rotation, it looks horrible. I don't think this Yankee – I think this Yankee team would have to play. Everyone's got to stay healthy. Everyone's got to perform to expectations, and they still might only be a third-place team.
Does Boone get fired in season?
In season, I think that's a stretch, dude.
Like if the wheels fall off.
If they come all the way off, like it just goes off the rails. If
you're trading Soto at the trade deadline, it's that bad. And Cole doesn't come back this year. Do they use the Cole situation as a way of saying, well, he didn't have his ace this year, and you know, maybe Judge gets hurt or Soto gets hurt in like May or something like that, and they sit there and go, we'll give him another year. Do you think that's possible, or is this it? Like, he's got to make the playoffs, or this is it.
If everyone's healthy and this team falls short, he's out. He has to be out at that point. But if Cole misses the whole year, Judge misses time, and, you know, they're bad enough. If you're bad enough to trade Soto at the deadline, unless that whole thing is because you're not getting the warm and fuzzy that negotiations are going to happen, right? If you're starting to have these conversations with his agent, and his agent's being real cold or whatever, you don't feel like Morris. You can pull off a contract. Right. If you don't feel like you can pull off a contract,
I would tell you
should trade him at that point. Yeah, and try to get something back. But, yeah, if everyone's healthy and we don't make the playoffs, I have to believe that Boone is out. If a bunch of dudes are hurt, Cole, Judge gets hurt again, God forbid Soto misses time too, I could totally see Cashman using it as an excuse to keep Boone around. I think he likes having Boone there as a puppet. I do.
Or a punching bag in front of him.
Or a punching bag, which is exactly what's going to happen to Nick Sirianni, too. It's the same fucking situation.
You know, here's what I find unbelievable when it comes to Soto, All right. This guy is probably going to get the biggest contract in the history of Major League Baseball outside of Otani. Yet, there's a possibility by the time he hits free agency, he'll be looking to sign with his fifth team.
Yeah, I know. I thought about that too.
If he gets traded, if he gets traded at the trade deadline from the Yankees, and then he goes to another team, plays for them, and then hits free agency, and he doesn't stay with that team, he'll be looking at his fifth team. Right. Like a player like that, who put up the numbers in the 2019 playoffs, it's unfathomable thinking about that.
It's insanity.
And he's
really
25,
is.
Right? This is his age 25 season?
This is his age 25 season. Yep. Yep. That's and crazy. A matter of fact, dude, if you look at it that way, so when he takes the field for the Yankees on opening day, that's going to be his third team since the start of the 2022 season. Start of 2022. Yeah. You don't even have to go back that far. It is a couple of years.
Yeah.
And then, like you said, if we trade him, that's four teams in three seasons.
Nuts.
And if he signs somewhere else after that, now it's five. Insane. At that age?
That level of talent.
It's amazing. Who keeps giving up on it? The power. He's got great plate discipline. He walks. I mean, he's projected to get 140 walks this year. I mean, he's just a walking machine. He's got great discipline at the plate. He's got the pop in his bat. He can hit for average, even though he's kind of slacked in that the last couple of years, maybe because he's been moving around so much. But, you know, he's won already as a young kid. He's proven he can do that. He's going to deserve every penny on that. And, man, what a talent.
This guy has led the league in walks each of the last three seasons, and that was age 22, 23, and 24.
Yeah.
That's almost unheard of.
It's right. Crazy to think about, too. It's kind of like the left – he's like the left-handed version of Mickey. Like, Miggy won young with the Marlins, but he only played with one team after that.
Right.
One team. So, like, think about Mickey's career taking this similar path that Soto's career has transpired. It is crazy to think about.
It is absolutely nuts to think about that many teams at that age and that amount of talent, dude. Like I said, age 22, 23, and 24. I would like to know if that's ever been done. Has somebody 22, 23, and 24 years old led the league in walks all three of those seasons?
I think Bonds did it at 35, 37.
Yeah, but you get what I'm getting at. The plate discipline at that young age is nuts.
Yeah.
I mean,
agreed.
By the way, Grambling State came back and won that game in overtime.
Wow. Nice.
Right. They were down by like 16. They won by 7 in overtime.
So, what is your official prediction on those? Right,
so the American League East,
yeah.
I've got Baltimore at the top, followed by Tampa Bay. If the Yankees. I think the Yankees' best case scenario is third place.
I don't agree. I mean,
look at the rest of the division, dude. I have no.
But the Blue Jays are better than them. The Blue Jays, to me, are better than them.
Yeah.
The Rays, the Broncos situation has left them pretty barren.
It is kind of a mess. Up. I get that.
And then, they lost some arms. They lost pitchers.
Yeah, they lost their ass.
That team always loses shit, and they still figure it out.
They traded Glass now. McClanahan's missing the whole season with Tommy John. I think the Blue Jays are a better team. I think the Rays missed the playoffs this year.
I think the Blue Jays hit better. I'm sorry, Toronto. And maybe it's just bitter for me because I've liked that Toronto team each of the last couple of years, and they keep coming up short, underachieving, if you will. And I just don't have. And then after I went there and saw no monuments and shit, I was kind of just fed up with them.
They're redoing the ballpark.
I know. Right after I fucking left. So you guys enjoy when you go up there. Take pictures for me.
I heard there's a Tim Hortons in center field now. I can't wait to see that.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it wasn't Tim Hortons in the damn ballpark.
Can you imagine watching a game from your hotel room and just like, you know, banging your wife?
Dude, I would totally lean her right up against the fucking room. There would be no question. I'm doing that. Throw me out of the hotel. I'll take the ticket, whatever. It's happening, dude. I think those rooms are like 700 or 800 a night, I want to say.
Wow.
We looked into it when the boys and I were going up there. We're like, holy shit. Yeah, no, we're going to skip that one.
Yes, sir.
But, yeah, you go to the freaking stadium. And, look, Chris, I'm sorry to bring up a sore subject.
Oh,
but
Jesus God.
Joe Carter's home run is one of the most iconic moments in the history of the fucking sport. It happens at that stadium. If you didn't know it happened, there's nothing there to tell you that it did.
I'm sorry. I unplugged my headphones.
But seriously, dude, how do you not have that somewhere? At least that.
I had to turn it off.
Nothing about Roy Halladay. It's just nothing. There's nothing anywhere. It was the – what's his name? Rogers outside the stadium. And if you ask the locals there, they would tell you it's a statue of him right before he bent down and picked up a penny off the ground. That's how they feel about it.
Yeah. So he probably put up his own statue.
Oh, I would imagine, yeah.
That's just horrific.
Yeah. So when you go, I would wait now until they do those renovations. Yeah. I would definitely wait. But enjoy it when you go. The CN Tower is literally right across the street from it. That place is cool. You won't have to hopefully deal with the wildfire smoke that I had to deal with, because on a clear day from up at the observation deck, you can actually see all the way across to Niagara Falls. Only we got up there and it was just fucking haze because the wildfires going on in Canada. But still pretty cool. Then the Hockey Hall of Fame is up there, Chris. I know you'll dive right into that. That place was awesome. It's in like the bottom level of a mall, and you wouldn't expect it. And it just like I don't even know how far into the ground they had to dig to go back in there. There is so much shit in that Hall of Fame. It worth the price of admission every day, dude. Place was awesome. Those were the three things we did that day. We were there for one day. And we did the CN Tower in the morning. We did the Hockey Hall of Fame in the afternoon. And then we went to the Jays game that night. And we caught him against the Angels. And it was Ohtani comes in and he's red hot. And sure as shit, second pitch of the ballgame. Whack! And the whole – everyone in the crowd is Asian. Right? So which was a little – I'm not sure if it was just the Ohtani thing because there was a lot of that.
There's a big Asian population up there.
Yes, and I was surprised. It was a little like
– what?
Fuck, you ever did that? Now, you know what I mean? your daughter was kind of in the age when the movie came out, the Pixar movie Turning Red. Did you watch that?
Oh, I don't know.
It's a good movie. The boys like it. I like it too. It's like this you know, this Asian girl. And she works like with her mom at like this this place. It's they worship obviously like you know like the Asian gods and stuff like that. And she's going through like a phase in her life, like she's becoming a teenager. So like they turn into like this red panda. It's part of like their you know adolescence that they're becoming. It's a pretty cool movie. There's like a big boy band concert that's going on at like the Rogers Center. And then her mom becomes like this really big, huge, giant, like red panda. Yeah, it's a cool movie, man. But yeah,
I may have watched it.
It's like a big Asian, you know, population that they have there in Toronto.
I've got three kids. They range in age from 11. Well, this year they'll be 11, 14, and 17. I've pretty much seen every Pixar movie from like 2000 to now, basically. Because even the ones that came out before my kids were born, they went back and watched them. And I've seen them all like probably 8 or 10 times at minimum, depending on which ones were their favorites. So some of it starts to kind of mesh together. Or some of it I turned into white noise because I just couldn't fucking stand it anymore. You know?
It's what Lou has to look forward to.
Yeah, you know what? If you look at two sides, I've got the kids that are older than yours, Chris. But and Lou, you're just starting out. But I will tell you, now that we're at this point and they don't need me as much, and some of the things that we used to play with start to go away. Like I just put a Lego table and Nerf guns and stuff into a storage unit to hold on to, because they just don't play with it anymore, and it starts to It's tough. It's difficult. And I'd be lying if I said I wasn't over the last year or two having a little bit of trouble because they just like forever, they're your entire world. And then it almost feels like overnight, they're just, you know, it's not that way anymore. Like they don't need you.
Oh, you were, Oh, you were still talking about the kids when you said you were having a little bit of trouble the last year or two. I was going to say there's a blue pill for that.
I ain't far off, bro. But at this point, I've already got the three kids.
I know. I could tell you're getting sentimental, so I had to.
Yeah.
Give you a little, you know, funny jab there. But, hey, while you're talking about it, you're telling us about Toronto. So why don't you tell everybody, you know, because I know you want to talk about it, the three of us, we're all on the same journey.
Yeah.
You know, all going different which ways and everything. We'd love to still try and get something together this year, but
yeah,
we'll try and make something happen. But I know you were saying that you're going to Iowa with the boys. And
yeah, we're going and Lou, you have the book, right? And
yes, Chris,
I think you keep track of your stuff a little differently. But
photos, shot glasses, baseballs for the kids. Yeah. Yep.
Lou and I both have that passport program, and I've also got the boys have it too. So the program is actually developed, created, and run by a gentleman who lives about 15 minutes away from me up in Middletown, Ohio here. Really good dude. And the whole program and the network has become a huge thing. And so every year he does what's called the Stampede. Most of the time it's right down here at Great American Ballpark. And that's, you show up, and the only thing you need is that big book, right? The big leather bound one. And the whole day is free as long as you have that book. So you register to go to the Stampede when they first announce it on the Facebook page. And then you show up, you get your little name tag, and it's a tour of the ballpark. It's a tour of the Reds Hall of Fame. It's a 90-minute kind of question and answer with a Reds legend. 2 years ago, it was George Foster. Last year, it was Marty Brenneman. And then you get to watch.
Not Tom Brenneman.
Not Tom. No. And thankfully, nobody asked questions about Tom.
It's a long fly ball to deep left. And Castellanos, and the Reds are winning 4-0.
Yeah. Thankfully, everyone avoided all that. I was scared that somebody was going to be a jackass and start asking questions. They didn't do it. After that, you go sit right behind the Reds dugout, batting practice, and then take it to the ballgame. You're at the ballpark for 12 hours, just about 10, 12 hours. And it's awesome. Well, this year, the Stampede is going to be at the Field of Dreams out in Iowa. Wow. Now, the boys and I had already been there. We went there in 2019 before they built all the MLB stadium and all that. When it was just the house, the field, the old little shack gift shop. Now it's all done up and stuff. But we get there in the afternoon, check in, and it's a tour of the house from where the movie was shot, which, by the way, actually is a bed and breakfast. They do rent out that room, although I think you have to book it I don't even know how many years in advance. But tour of the house and then lunch. Kids run the bases, 12 and under. We're going to play a softball game on the field. Awesome. And then that night, we'll, you know, popcorn, hot dogs and shit, sitting on the field, watching the movie while we're sitting on the field.
I got to cry in front of everybody?
Oh, dude. You should have seen me when we went in 2019, dude. We walk out onto the field, and you just pull up and walk right out onto it. There's no admission or anything like that. You just go. We walk out there, and the boys have their gloves, and I'm just out there, and Liam turns and throws a ball to me, and I quick with my sunglasses put them over my eyes. I'm like, oh, my God.
Pulling the Travis Kelce at Jason Kelce's press conference.
Dude, it was pretty
rare. Sunglasses in the front row in the auditorium.
What I will tell you, if you do ever go, keep this in mind. Everyone wants to walk into the cornfield, right? So I had my Mickey Mantle jersey with me. I was going to have the boys record me in that walking into the corn. Well, we went in late June. And the saying with corn, I found this out later, knee high by the 4th of July. Oh. So wait a little later in the year before you go, if you decide to go. We are doing that at the beginning of August. The other thing we're doing is actually in a couple of weeks. Where are we at? The 20th? So, actually, it's two weeks
from this weekend.
2 weeks from today. 2 weeks from today, we will shove off for Washington, D.C. And that Friday night, the boys and I are going to go knock off the National Stadium. And I hear I'm going to be pretty disappointed. But you got to check it off. I've been to the Trop, which is a disaster. So this can't be that much worse.
They built up the area really nice around it. Like when
Navy Yard, right? Navy Yard is called that area.
Well, yeah, down in that area, they built it up. It's got bars and restaurants and all that stuff now. Like when it opened years ago, there was nothing around there. There was, it was just the ballpark right on the water, right next to this, you know, kind of, you know, second rate bridge that they have like running over from DC into Maryland. And then like they had a storage container bar outside, like their main gate is in left center. So it was like a, it was a bar. It was built up with storage containers, C boxes. And like that was their main attraction. I didn't really take notice of that when I brought Jacob down there. We did the Air and Space Museum on the 4th of July last year. But you know, it's not as bad as like I remember it being. It was actually decent.
Yeah.
You know, it's not a great atmosphere. You know, the Nationals fans did, obviously now the team is not great. So like going to a game, there's not going to be a lot of people there. But I always said it was a spaceship with a parking garage attached to it.
That's what they call it, the stadium down in the Trop. And you guys have been there.
Yeah.
You just know some of the locals call it the land boob.
The land boob. That's right.
Yep.
Yeah.
And you see, if you look at from like a, it looks like a tit.
Stick it, I only went to the Trop one time, and I'll never go
once.
Back.
Game, I went once.
Game one World Series 2008. Phillies win 3-2.
That's we had I just – it was the year I'd switched jobs. We were in Tennessee, and I had switched jobs. And so I only had limited amount of time to throw a trip together. So we – thankfully for me, I got a buddy in Tampa. So we just flew down, stayed with him, went to the game, hung out at his pool for like a day and a half, and then came back. Look, is it a great stadium? No, it's not. The worst part about it is the location, though. That having to drive over to St. Pete is a fucking nightmare. And nobody wants to do that.
They're going to stick to it because the new ballpark supposedly is going to be built right next to it. So
I heard, which I think is insane.
Yeah, it's a mistake.
It is. I do think it's a mistake. They should have tried to move heaven and earth to put that thing in Ybor, dude.
Yeah.
My opinion.
Agreed.
The other thing we're going to try to do, and it's going to take a lot of hawking the low fare flights because we got a bunch of other shit planned this summer. I'm going to be watching flights to Denver very closely this summer. I'd really like to get that one. I want to get out there. You got the ballpark museum right across the street from it. That's a nice attraction I'd like to go check out. But I really want to go to Coors Field. I hear it's amazing.
It is.
So
yeah.
And then
I really want to go.
Amazing.
So that's what we got on tap.
Yeah. You know, last year we did Coors. Me and my wife went there last May. Mm-hmm. And I will say this, the altitude is real.
Yep.
Well, we went to the Birds game out there just a couple of years ago.
Holy
fucking
hell.
Up to that upper level, my feet were pretty fucking heavy, dude.
I mean,
did you go up to the purple seats up in Coors?
We went up. So what they do, like, so now they got rid of up in right field. They have the party area now. So they tore out all the seats up in the upper deck in right field all the way over to the right field foul pole. And it's like, it's bars and like they had the one bar, they were giving out free beers up until like first pitch. I was like, I'm in. it was pretty cool up there. We did that on the Saturday night. We sat like three rows behind the Phillies dugout on a Friday night. And then we sat first baseline on Sunday afternoon. I love Coors. It
looks amazing.
It's close top five. You know, if I add CBP in there for me out of the ones I've done, it's clean. What they do is after every game, they repaint like the stadium. Like they keep it fresh with everything. Like
Holy shit.
Yeah, it's crazy. They were telling us about this. Like they pressure wash everything. They repaint the parts of the ballpark. Yeah.
It must be the city doing it because they get all that funding from the taxes off of weed.
Probably. Yeah. But Lou, what's your plan this upcoming summer? I'm anxious to hear where you're actually going to go.
Where's 305 Sports Travel headed for the baseball season?
We have not made that decision yet. I will say this, though, and you guys are not going to like this answer, but I got to be honest. I have a feeling that Oakland is going to make an announcement that they're out of there and they're going to start playing in that Triple-A park in Vegas. And
this year?
I think so.
They have a lease on that stadium for a couple more years, right?
No. I think they have a get out after this year.
This year.
And I think it's a done deal, right? So I think that they're going to head out of town this year and just start playing in that Triple-A park in Vegas. I really think that's going to be what's going to happen. And look, I know it's a dump. I get it. But I do have that book that you mentioned about Adam, and it's on there. I know I can switch it out. But there's also – look, that there was A's teams, you know, won four championships there. And then, you know, I love my Dolphins, and the Dolphins actually had a crazy game, a couple of crazy games there. But they had a chance to three-peat, which nobody to this day has done. And the Sea of Hands game, very famous game. Dolphins lost on the last possession. And so just to get that out of my system and to be in that same stadium where that took place and just experience it before they – you can never do it again, right? I think that might be a choice to get out there.
I'm bummed that I'm not going to be able to get there. It's just not in the cards.
It's great. So it doesn't bum me actually out. Get there.
Yeah.
It's great to say that until you actually get there.
Yeah, no, I get it. I know it's a dump, but look, it's one of the it's the last remaining ballpark that housed football and baseball, right? It's got its history to it. It's not good.
Ricky Henderson played there.
There you go.
That's enough for me.
Catfish Hunter, you know, Reggie Jackson before he went to the Yankees.
I loved Ricky when I was a kid until you find out how much of a dick he was. But, like, you know, he was so much fun to watch as a kid.
Don't meet your heroes.
Yeah. No, most of the time it's a disappointment. Yeah, it really is.
Have you guys ever been as what was it? It's Oracle Park.
I've been. Yeah, okay.
So you've been there. So it's not like you can knock both of them out and then, you know, in a couple day stretch.
No, that was the idea for the boys and I. We were going to try to do that at some point. Now San Francisco becomes its own trip. It's like,
But so, yeah, if I could get Ash out there, she's never been to Oracle. So we could do those two. But that's what we've thought about, but nothing's been set in stone yet. I'm at 17 presently, 21 overall, four that are no longer in circulation. So I'm at 17 right now presently, and I'm more than halfway through. So how about you guys? Where are you guys at?
We've got I've got 19 total, three that are no longer – because I was at the ballpark at in Arlington back in 15. Yeah. And, of course, old Yankee Stadium and Shea Stadium. But the only ones I really count are the ones the boys and I have been together.
Right.
So that sits at 16 with Nationals Park coming this year. So, yep. Okay.
24 total, 21 active.
Nice.
San Diego is going to get knocked out at the end of April. So me and Rachel are going out. I got tickets for Friday night and Sunday afternoon with the Phillies there. We're gonna do a night. We have a nice hotel that's a mile away from the stadium, so nice walking distance. Our room is gonna be facing the bay right there in San Diego. We're gonna do a nice dinner on Saturday night. So yeah, I'm looking forward to that. I've never been to San Diego at all. I can't wait. It's going to be awesome. It's going to be a great time. So I'll be 22. 23 is slated for early August. I know the three of us have previously talked about how I thought the last one I was going to get to was going to be Seattle. but after doing Minnesota last year with my dad and my best friend, you know, my best friend of 26 years, his father had passed away the week that we went to Minnesota. So when we were out there, we all kind of made a pact that we were going to do another boys trip the following year. And it just lined up that the Phillies were going to be that very same weekend. The Phillies were going to be in Seattle. So we're going to knock that one out this year. Flights are a little expensive. They're like 700 round trip, something like that right now.
Yeah. You can't get them cheap from anywhere. It's about the same thing. Fly from here to there. Yeah. It's nuts.
Yeah. American Airlines, Alaskan Airlines, whatever the hell you got to fly.
Delta. They're all the fucking same. Yeah. 700. It's about 700 a flight. So I told my boys, I'm like, well, you don't know if to pay for your own flight, then we can go to Seattle.
Yeah. So that'll be 23. And I'm trying to plot my way because the only one that's left within driving distance is Toronto. It's an 8-hour drive, you know, getting through customs and whatnot. So I would love to do that with.
It's quick, dude. You fly over the border.
Yeah.
It's harder coming back in, which was nice to see.
Yeah. I mean, we were talking about, like, getting the boys, you know, passports and then going up and, you know, doing Niagara Falls and whatnot
cards.
With the kids. Yeah.
Passport cards, they can get it. They don't even have to do the full-on passport. They have passport cards, like $20.
Yeah.
Bucks.
Yeah.
You're done.
It's probably what I'm looking at. I would like to, you know, make that one happen, too.
Well, the cool part about that is from where you're at, you can go up through and hit Cooperstown either on the way up or on the way back. And just, I know you've been there a bunch, but you can do it again.
Yeah, I'm not going to do that with the kids until they're older.
How old are your boys again?
Jacob turns 8 next month, and Carson just turned 5. So
yeah, I'd wait.
Yeah, I mean, Cooperstown's, like, I like walking around the town and going in all the stores and all stuff, but they're not ready for for that yet. So me and Rach keep on doing that. But, Lou, are you guys getting married this year?
I think that's the plan. We're still trying to figure it out. But it's trending to that. So, yes, we'll let you know.
You're going to get married at the ballpark?
Not the ballpark. But you're not going to be surprised where it's going to be. So I'll just leave it at that. Shit. But look, going back to what you're going to knock off this year, Chris, definitely been to both of those. Seattle's awesome. When I went, I went with my dad. We actually took an Alaskan cruise previous to it. We went to T-Mobile Park at the time, what it was called. No, it was called Safeco. Now it's called
T-Mobile. Safeco, yeah.
The old Safeco. We actually saw King Felix on King Felix night. He pitched. They gave out the yellow shirts with the K on
field line. Yep.
And they had a whole, this court session. It was amazing. So that was a great experience. They got Edgar's Cantina for Edgar Martinez, obviously. Ken Griffey stuff all over. So you're going to love it. And then Petco Park, man, that is my number two park. My number 5 is Dodger. Number 4 is Coors. 3 Oracle, 2 Petco, and 1 Wrigley. Petco Park, amazing. I mean, what they've done around that ballpark is
it looks fantastic.
The Tony Gwynn section, you got to go to the 392 bar, 394 bar, sorry, for his highest batting average. It's called Club 394, dedicated to all Tony Gwynn. Just fantastic. You're going to love the ballpark. They got a bar in the Great Western Metal Supply Company building, which is a big, building in left field.
Right down the left field line, but the pole.
They build the ballpark around. There's a bar there and great sight lines all around there. So you're going to have a great time. And San Diego's a tremendous city as well. I would tell you, maybe you'd want to heed this advice or not, don't venture into Mexico, specifically Tijuana. But besides that, I think you're going to be all right.
Do you know from experience?
Can't really share that story. But
I'm looking forward to both of them. San Diego is already set in stone. We bought the tickets, we booked the flights, we have the hotels. Like we're getting. My in-laws are going to take the kids for the weekend. So yeah, it's going to be nice getaway for the two of us. And then Seattle. I talked to my dad last week at the Flyers game, and then I was texted with my best friend when I was smoking cigars out in the patio on Saturday night, which was just weird to be smoking cigars outside in the patio on March 16th up in here in the Northeast. But it was nice to be outside. It was beautiful to get out there to do that.
Lou's headed out to his patio when we're done here.
Hey, he can do that anytime.
Right, you're around, baby.
Yeah, he can do that anytime. I remember Ash was posting a picture of her next to the pool like a day or two after you guys got back from Kansas City. And I'm just like, look at her thawing out by the pool.
Yeah.
Incredible. And Adam, I got to say, I did take Chris's Lone Depot virginity. So, that's on your bucket list, and I'll be glad to take yours as well, my friend.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. You know it, brother.
It's actually a sneaky good park. I mean, it's not like highly.
It looks nice.
But it's the only thing that sucks about it. Actually, there's a couple things that suck about it, but it's a nice ballpark. I liked our seats were really good. Walking around the concourse, you have the bar out there in left center field. The bobblehead section of the ballpark, it's really cool. It's just in the middle of
Little Havana.
Yeah, it's like a neighborhood. Yeah. We parked in front of someone's house, but it's not like you're parking in front of someone's house at like Wrigley Field in Wrigleyville.
Yeah,
it's like a different field.
That's what I was gonna say. Is it like that? Because I actually paid a guy to use his garage when we went to Wrigley. Wow. He was renting his garage space. He's just out there with a sign, $40. I'm like, hey, whatever. It wasn't the only one. There were people up and down the street. Yeah, parking here. My freaking driveway is the size of my bed. Yeah.
But it's also got no personality. Like if you look at the exterior of the stadium, they kept that stupid ass left center field home run statue that's outside somewhere. Like there's no personality to the stadium at all. And then I don't know if they've improved the banners for the World Series champions,
no,
Lou.
No, they didn't.
They suck.
Embarrassing.
Yeah, it's just like, you know, like you would think that they would try and, you know, put that out there a little bit more. Like, hey, man, you guys have been around since 1993, and you've won the same amount of World Series as my team that's been around since 1883. There's only one Major League Baseball franchise that's been around longer than the Phillies, and that's the Cincinnati Red Sox.
Yeah, and believe, come on out here. They don't let you fucking forget it.
Yeah, but they won't fucking tell you in the stadium.
But because none of them are there.
Exactly.
Right. Unless it's opening day, nobody's there. And even on a Tuesday night, they do 3-2-1 Tuesdays. Lou, I think I told you about that.
They told me. Yeah, that's right.
$3 beer, $2 hot dog, $1 ice cream. Every Tuesday night. And you got, like, you know, 5,000 people there. I'm like, all right, man, cool. Fuck. They're freaking Scranton Wilkes-Barre Rail Riders draw more than the Reds.
I know Lou wanted to dive into some milestones.
Yeah, I got a couple here that I wrote down. Let me entertain you here for a second. So Andrew McCutchen, love Cutch, right? He needs one more homer to get to 300. Nice little milestone there. Paul Goldschmidt, 91 hits to get to 2,000. We mentioned Mike Trout earlier. He's 32 homers away from 400, and he's 60 RBIs away from 1,000. Still yet 31 years old, so he's got to have a shot. He's got to stay healthy, though.
He's got to stay healthy.
Yeah, I mean, 500, I think, is a lot. You know, he could do that at 31. Can he get to 600? Not sure, but he's 32 away from 400, and that could fall this year. Jose Abreu, 47 RBIs from 1,000. He's only done that in 10 seasons. He started being 26 years old, so that's pretty remarkable. He's been steady his whole career. Rizzo, 70 RBIs from 1,000. This is one of my, like, Machado needs 56 RBIs for 1,000. He's only 30 years old, Machado.
Yeah. He's young.
He came up really young, dude.
Yeah.
Yeah. At 30 years old, getting to 1,000, which he will this year, he's going to put up some numbers the rest of the way. Judge is 43 homers away from 300. And then I got
stays healthy. That probably happens this season.
Yeah, very well could.
Should be mid-August if he's doing it right.
Yep. I'll end it with a couple of Phillies, but last one before that, you got Kershaw. We don't know when he's going to play, but he's 66. He's 56 strikeouts away from 3K. And Zach Greinke, who's currently not signed, Adam, you might need a starter. He's 21K away from 3,000. Hey, he's got to come back to get 21 strikeouts. I'm not saying it's got to be with the Yankees, but when you're 21 away from 3K, come back and pick for something.
What the fuck is this Bernie Mac movie over here, Mr. 3000? I got to bring this.
Come on.
Adam, hold on. You have enough threes and fives in your rotation. What about Lou? Lou has a minor league pitching staff. You need Zach Greinke.
You need Zach Greinke to put some asses in seats to maybe come see that 3,000 strikeout.
Nah, he doesn't like fans. I don't even think he doesn't like fans.
He's a little wacky. So
he would fit in well in Miami because they don't show up. So,
that's he can't get in his head.
He just has to be nice to Lou and Ash.
That's pretty much it. And then the last one.
Where's one of her low cut tops? I think he'll be in.
Agreed. I'll end it with a couple of Phillies. So both Nola and Wheeler can get to 100 wins this year. Nola's 10 away and Wheeler is 13 away. So a couple milestones to keep your eye on in the season.
Yeah. Listen, man, milestones are what's great. I'd say all the time, man, about baseball, the probably the best thing that I can sell people on with the game of baseball is you could see anything that you've never seen before when you go to the ballpark. And that's, I've been to over 1,000 games. Like it's crazy how many baseball games I've seen. And like last year, the first time I got to see the cycle in person, Luis Arraez did it against my team last April. It's amazing what you have the ability to see and the people that you get to meet, the friends you get to make, like you guys, you know, like the common bond that we all share in the game of baseball. I'll say this, like, I know a lot of people want to say, you know, with the rule changes and all that stuff, and like, I could still deal without the rule changes. I would still watch a 4-hour baseball game. I don't give a shit. Don't care at all.
Same.
But if they do this this whole realignment bullshit with this Eastern Conference and Western Conference thing, and I'm in a division the Phillies are in a division with the Yankees, the Mets, and the Red Sox, I'm going to be fucking pissed. Because I really don't understand what we're trying to change here in baseball. Like, if you want to go four divisions National League and four divisions American League, and you want to go four teams through, have at it. Do whatever you want to do. But do not break up the tradition. Yeah. Don't mix up with tradition with American and National League. It's already weird. It's still weird enough that the Astros moved to the American League.
It's okay. So I'm not alone with that, right?
It's still weird.
Feels a little weird, right?
Still weird.
Yeah.
I mean, playing the World Series as a National League team, you know, just
right. And it's strange. I mean, it's just 20 years ago, right? Yeah, it's not that long.
It's been about 10. I think 2011, 2012 is where they made the move.
Yeah. No, but he's talking about the last.
I'm talking about the World Series.
That they won. Okay.
2005. Yeah, 2005. Yeah, 2005.
When they lost to the White Sox.
Yep, they got swept. Yep. Mm-hmm. That was the year that Lidge gave up the home run in the NLCS to Pujols. It still hasn't landed yet.
My God, I'll never forget. Holy shit.
I say all the time, if the roof was open that night, the ball would have hit the building on the other side of the street.
That ball was still going up.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh. Incredible.
It's not too many times you see a ball get hit that hard.
No,
not at all. It was I'd like to thank Albert for that though, because if he didn't, you know, throw his career off the train tracks, on that given night, he wouldn't have wound up with the Phillies in 2008 to, you know,
when he had the perfect season.
Yeah, 48 for 48.
Yep.
Chris, I do want to piggyback off what you said, man. Look, the game doesn't need change, you know, it's great as it is. And look, it's the only game without a clock, right? So why are we – I get it. You want the kids to be in and all that, but don't cheat guys like us. I was thrilled to be at the ballpark when you told me it's free baseball, right? It's tied game. You don't know when it's going to end. I saw Roger Clemens go 9 innings against the Marlins, not get a decision, and that game went 17 innings when he was with the Blue Jays. And me, my dad, my brother couldn't have been happier to stay there. Well, maybe my dad wanted to go home and get his rest, but me and my brother – being at the ballpark at 12:45, almost 1 o'clock in the morning on a Wednesday night in a game that Roger Clemens started. Give me all that and more. You know, I don't need you to put a runner at second base with these softball rules and tell me that.
That's the one that bothers me the most.
The ghost runner
bullshit. I cannot stand.
Yeah.
I just can't stand it. But to back you up, Lou, I mean, I could spend, like I just told you about the Stampede. You're at the ballpark for 12 hours.
Great.
It's glorious. And I'm not even a Reds fan, and I enjoy it. Yankee Stadium, 2009. My wife and I get married mid-July. We go back to Connecticut, visit fam. My mother throws a reception for us there. My friend Sam gives us tickets to Yankees Red Sox. Right field bleachers, right where I used to sit, only at the new ballpark instead. The game goes, what was it, the 15th inning? Something like 15th inning? Rodriguez walks it off with a solo homer, 1-0. I wasn't going anywhere. This guy's sitting behind me. His wife is pregnant. Rodriguez hits the bomb. He screams, "Yeah, I gotta be to work in 1 fucking hour." It's like, you weren't gonna leave.
No.
Some of that's Yankee Red Sox. I get it, but like, I don't need it to be sped up. The problem is the younger generation does. And if baseball only continues to pitch to guys like us, baseball will die.
Yeah.
And that's what you don't. That's the worst thing. That's the worst case. I didn't really know how the hell they were going to fix their problem. Because the two biggest problems were the game takes the complaints, right, from your younger generation. The game takes too long, and there's not enough runs scored. Those were the two biggest problems they had. Not enough action. Well, up to that point, in order for the game to go faster, you don't score as much. And if you want more scoring, the fucking game takes too long. I didn't know how the hell they were going to fix it, and they did. Because we still get plenty of run production, and those games are over in 2.5 hours.
Yeah.
It's actually pretty impressive, to be perfectly honest with you.
I will say, though, the stolen bases, I thought there'd be a lot more. You know, you talk about Ricky Henderson. I thought we were going to go back to the Ricky Henderson, Vince Coleman days where, you know, 100 bags would be taken. But nobody did that.
And analytics.
I love
analytics.
Yeah,
I get it. That's what it is. It's still the analytics. Now, there was an uptick in steals, but not. Yes. I don't think we'll ever see it as like
it's never going to get back to that.
It won't go back to that.
Yeah, I mean they were just don't run enough. Yeah, and they were just doing it just to do it. I mean, like, they could, yeah. You know.
Ricky would just take off.
Dude. Yeah.
Like, right. He got caught stealing a freaking ton of times, too. He just right. didn't give a shit. It's like volume steals, right? Like, yeah. Like, well, I'm gonna, like a volume three-point shooter. Time. I'm just going to keep going, dude.
See, I was at a 19-inning game with the Phillies the one time. And Wilson Valdez, the Phillies ran out of pitchers. Danny's Baez had to pitch 4 innings. Danny's Baez.
Really, Danny's Baez.
He had to pitch 4 innings. I mean, the guy couldn't pitch again for like a week after that. But Wilson Valdez, who is one of our utility guys, came in to pitch the 18th and the 19th against the Reds. And it was like he got Scott Rowland and he got Joey Votto out in the 19th inning, and then we wound up walking it off in the bottom of the 19th.
How about a douchebag owner? I go back to Castellini out here. So Votto wants to continue playing. He signed a minor league deal with the Blue Jays. You're the Reds owner. You know that this man wants to continue playing. You're obviously not going to pay him $20 million to do so. But he's willing to take this small peanuts contract. How the hell is he not still in your uniform? With all of that youth that this Reds team is bringing up, trying to tell me that guy couldn't do a whole lot of good in that clubhouse? Now, Votto's from Canada. Maybe he just wanted to go home.
Yeah.
But it feels a whole lot like Castellini is just a douchebag.
I think if he had his druthers, he would still be with the Reds. I mean,
I gotta believe that, man. He spent his whole career here.
Yeah, Votto's a traditionalist, and he respects the game.
Agreed.
So he's the type of guy that I'm sure it would be a lot. It would be a prideful thing for him, especially like is Votto Hall of Fame?
We talked about that. I think he is, right? I mean, he is.
I think he's going to get in, but he's one of those guys to where it's yay or nay. Like it's pretty close.
Yes. It's your more modern type of stats that are going to get him in. It's the on base percentage stuff.
Right.
Right. Yeah. He's not going to reach the milestone numbers, if you will. He's going to come close, but he's not going to get those milestones. But you're right. He walks a ton, and it's those stats that are going to help his cause.
MVP. That helps. Yeah. Doing it all pretty much in one jersey. Yeah, but
yep,
he's a great player, and it would have been, but he was a great Red, and like I understand, he's Canadian. He lives 25 minutes away from the ballpark up there in Toronto.
Yep.
But you know, for me, like we were just talking about earlier, I would have loved to have seen Votto finish it out in Cincinnati. Yes. If that's where it was going to end, that's where it should end.
Agreed.
That's where it should have ended. Now you got it. So it's just he'll be 40 years old this year, 2024. It'll be his 18th season. He's got 356 homers, 1,144 RBIs. So he doesn't have 2,135 hits. So he is not going to sniff any kind of big man. He's not going to get to 400 homers. You know, he's not going to reach 1,500 RBIs.
What's his career WAR? That's a big thing too.
Yeah. It is. That's what I mean about it. He's going to get in on the modern stuff.
Numbers.
Yeah. His career WAR is 64.5. Now that's likely to only go down from here because he has really fallen off the shelf.
That's if he makes the major league roster, though. I mean, keep in mind,
very true. You may not. This is a guy who batted 202 with 14 homers last year.
And Vladdy's a gold glove first baseman,
yeah,
for the Jays.
Yeah,
so like, how much is he gonna be able to play there? They're gonna try and put their big bats in the DH situations. Like, he's not really gonna play that much,
right? No, he's not. Gets hurt. But when you look at his 162-game average, his career on-base percentage is .409. His career slugging is .511, which puts his OPS at .920, which is another stat that your modern folks on OPS, on-base percentage, the WAR, he's likely to get in. It's just not the traditional numbers that the three of us would like to see. Give me 500 homers. Give me 3,000 hits. You know, 1,800 RBIs, whatever you want to call it. 1,500 RBIs, that kind of shit. But
yep.
294 career batting average, 28 homers, 90 RBIs. That's his 162-game average. Pretty fucking good.
No doubt. And not a sexy
category. For a long time.
Yeah, for a long, exactly, over almost 20 years. Not a sexy category, but walks. In looking at my research, he's not going to get it. But he needed like 80 walks, I want to say, to get – he won't get it. Nowhere close. But to get, I think, 1,500 for his career, which – puts him as one of only 19 players to do that, and all those other 18 previously are all in the Hall of Fame. So
he's had 13. He's got 1,365 walks,
except for Bonds, right?
Well, yeah, he's
whatever happened to that guy?
He stopped doing steroids.
Wasn't he the hitting coach for the Marlins at one point?
He was.
Yeah.
Mark Pryor is the pitching coach for the Dodgers.
Yeah.
That explains a lot with the Tommy John shit.
Oh, jeez. Yeah, just keep doing this. Your arm will eventually just fall right off.
Man, he was so good those couple years.
He was so good.
Oh, him and Kerry Wood. Oh, God. Yeah.
That 1998 baseball season, and I know it was steroid-induced. Everyone knew it. But the home run chase, and it was more than that. Alex Rodriguez went 40-40 as an infielder, right? Unheard of. That just the first guy to do that.
Griffey still hit over 50.
Griffey smashed 50.
Yeah. Almost.
Kerry Wood struck out 20 in a game.
Yeah.
The Yankees.
Pedro
went bananas.
The big Yankees, unit.
As a season, when you take in the World Series, final record of 125-50. I mean, there was just a lot of shit that happened that year that was absolutely awesome.
Tony Gwynn and the Padres going to the World Series. Well, Kevin Brown had a phenomenal year that year.
Yeah, he did.
I mean, it's just like, yeah, just
there was a lot of cool shit happened that year.
The Killer Bees, you know, with the Astros. Right. Yeah.
Yep. Before they became the fucking killer banging on drums.
The Phillies were awful that year.
Everything was right with the world.
Yeah, that was year two of Terry Francona. And you know, the Marlins were just as bad because they sold away everybody that helped them win a World Series.
Yeah.
And you've done that twice.
Two times, you know? Man. I'll never. The biggest crush for me was, you know, trading away Miguel Cabrera, man. Why? I mean, that's the guy, the one guy that they should have seen what he was headed for and kept him in the uniform, man, for his career. And
but at least that was a few years after you guys won the title. Like, it's not like 2004 they traded away Mickey. Like, it's like to tear everything down as quickly as they did. Like, yeah. I think 98 was worse after the 97 World Series. You guys just were like,
see, oh, yeah. They just absolutely unloaded.
Who stuck around? Charles Johnson?
He did. Yep. PJ stuck around. Sheffield stuck around for half a season.
Renteria, didn't he stick around for a little bit?
He did, but we shipped him out as well. The biggest, the funniest thing for me is that Mike Piazza was at Marlin for about 4 days, you know?
A fucking cup of coffee. He was there, yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, that was the biggest FU. It's just, yeah, it's awful.
Yeah, I'm not sticking around here. Trade me somewhere else. I think you trade him to the Mets.
Yeah.
What a joke. What a joke of a franchise. Like, dude, they're retiring everybody's number there now. It's like ever since Steve Cohen, fanboy, took over that franchise, it's like really, like, the reason why you didn't sustain the success of the 86 Mets was because the two guys that you're honoring with retiring their numbers were so friggin' coked out.
Yeah.
They couldn't stay off the drugs.
Just them, dude.
But I get that. But let's retire Strawberry's number. Let's retire Doc
Gooden's
number.
I'm pretty sure Hernandez was the one dealing the coke to him, dude.
Probably from St. Louis, yeah. Like, I mean, seriously. Like, they're going to have – they're trying to retire more numbers than the Yankees. It's just like – what are we doing here? Like,
you hit the nail on the head with your first part of your statement, fanboy. That's what he is. He's a rich fan. That's all he is. And you saw it last year. I'm going to go get Verlander. I'm going to go get Scherzer. Now, the only thing I will tell you is, to his credit, recognize that it was a mistake and recognize he had to get him out of there. Right? Like, I've got it. I can't just sit here on this. I'm going to have to eat a bunch of the money, but let's at least we're trying to recoup something from them and move on.
Right.
So I think he's stuck with Lindor, though, man. I don't think that guy's going.
You can't unload that. Yeah, I don't know.
And I think, dude, I don't know that they can allow Pete to walk out the door or trade him. The Met fans love Pete Alonso, dude.
It's because they're douchebags like him.
Oh, I totally get it, dude. I'm not.
But the guy was lifting weights and grunting in between home
run derby.
at bats. Like, what the fuck is
wrong with
you?
He's a look at me guy. He's a douche.
He is such a douche. Like, I'm sorry. Like, he belongs in a Mets uniform because he's a douchebag. They're all fat, worthless fucks up there anyway.
Tell us how you really feel, Chris.
You know, I kept my mouth shut.
I knew I could get him going with the Pete Alonso thing. The only guy I haven't brought up yet is that fucker in Atlanta.
there might be one guy in New York that I hate more than Alonso. And he's just a try-hard douchebag. And when he walks, he sprints to first base like a giant tool bag. And his name is Brandon Nimmo. What a complete Rudy loser. Like, I can't stand that dork. And, like, everyone's like, oh, he's so fast. The dude hasn't stolen more than, like, 10 bags in a season.
Yeah.
Like, he's not that fast. He looks fast when he runs, when everybody else trots down the first base on a walk. Outside of that, take the speed and shove it up your ass.
They keep trying to pass him off as a leadoff hitter. He's not.
No. No, he only leads off because the rest
Brandon
of the team
Nimmo.
Sucks.
Yeah. Finding Nimmo.
Brandon Nimmo.
Yeah.
Brandon Nimmo has never stolen more than 9 bases in his entire career.
But he's fast.
He's got 26 steals, and he's been caught 17 times.
Unbelievable. Unbelievable.
But he's fast.
But he's fast. He's fast. He's got so much coverage in center field.
Yeah, that's great.
What a tool bag. And then if someone tries to sell me on Brett Beatty being a major league third baseman again, I'm just going to laugh in your face. I'm sorry. I've seen enough of that guy to know he sucks. He's Cody Ashy in a Mets uniform.
Might as well bring back Daniel Vogel back.
Vogel bat fat. Bat fat. Good Lord.
That dude, you want to talk about a guy who's enjoying the all-you-can-eat seats. Jesus Christ.
Yeah. The best thing, I don't know if you guys follow. I know Adam probably follows Frank the Tank, the big giant. He's also a huge Dolphins fan, Lou. He works for Barstool.
I've heard of him.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Giant, enormous fat fuck. But, like, the audacity of him to call another man fat, like Vogelback, and then you look at this guy that, like, I'm talking, man, like, he hasn't seen his dick in probably a decade. Like, that's how fat he is. And for him to call Vogelback fat is just, like, the epitome of hypocrisy. There's 0%. When he sits on the toilet, he hopes that he's peeing.
Oh, man.
You got to get the reinforced. They're like the prison toilet, right, where it's all iron. So it doesn't fucking break.
Or the urinal that goes all the way to the floor. Yeah, right. That's how he pees.
Right, he just shits in the pissing. Like, what are you doing, you fat bastard?
I haven't seen my Willy in 2 years. Yeah. It's long enough to consider it. Consider it legally dead.
Maybe lay off the cheesecake there, Slick. Jesus Christ.
Now we're getting off the rails.
Yeah. Now we're getting off the rails. So, final thoughts, guys? What do you got?
Well, what's your guys' World Series prediction? I gave mine. So, what do you guys got?
So, what did you say? Adam, you said
over Phil's.
He's got Orioles over 83 Phil's.
World Series. And the same result. But it'll go longer than 5 games this time.
So I have props. You're not going to like this one, but I got the Braves in the National League. And I'm with you, Adam. The Orioles. No, did you say Orioles? You did.
I had the Orioles win in division, but the Orioles would be my pick for
that. That's my World Series, and I hate to say it. I got the Braves winning it.
Oh.
I hate to say it, but that's my pick.
So I would have the same 2 teams in the World Series. I just think that the Braves are just a tick better. Although it wouldn't shock me if it's a Philly. I really like that Phillies team, dude. It's hard for me to root against them, and it's just because I think they have a nice fucking blend, right? You got some veteran dudes in there. You still got the young guys. It's a nice blend of dudes. I like Wheeler and Nola at the top of the rotation. When you have to look for an X factor, Ronald Acuña Jr., dude. And I know, Chris, I know you can't stand him, but Jesus Christ. .330 batting average, 40 homers and 70 steals last year. I mean, to think he's going to put up replicate that again, I agree with some of what you said before. Not everybody's just going to keep doing that. What's stopping him? He's a spaz. So when you look at an X factor, I think he's the, I don't know, like, where is the rest of the National League? I have no faith in the Dodgers to do shit. I don't want to hear about the Diamondbacks coming back up and doing that.
No, no. Hey, listen, you've seen the Dodger act so many times before.
Right. Win one in a regular full season, then I'll believe. Until then,
But there's only three teams in the National League.
Yes.
There's only three that you can realistically say is going to go to the World Series.
And Dodgers and Phillies.
I pray for it, Lou. I pray for it. The last 2 years, especially last year, the way things lined up with the bracket and knowing that we were going to have to get the Braves in the second round, I want the Braves in the NLCS. I want the, like, everyone's like, oh, well, the Phillies are built to beat them in five, in a five-game series. I don't know so much about the seven-game series. I'm sorry. Must-watch TV.
Oh, yeah.
Is no Phillies, question. Braves, NLCS. There's no doubt about it. That's what the people want to see. Like, the last 2 years, we've had – you know, actually, if you look at the history of, like, the Phillies and playing in the we play, like, nothing but the West when it comes to the NLCS.
Right.
Nothing but the West. I mean, the Diamondbacks, the Padres – the Giants, the Dodgers, 93, the Braves were in the National League West, you know, 83, the Dodgers, 80, the Astros, you know, but that when it was only the East and the West.
It was only East and West, yeah.
Like, we only play the West. I want, for the love of God, I want the Braves and the NLCS. I want that matchup more than anything in this world. If I get that, I've already dealt with the Dodgers. We beat the Dodgers' ass in the playoffs plenty of times in my lifetime. I need the Braves.
The Dodgers can't hang with you guys in a short series, dude.
Not in pitching. Not with their pitching.
No. You guys you'll out-arm them to death.
Yeah,
that's what will
happen. And that's both the bullpen and that's the rotation.
You're just deeper.
Yeah. And that's not saying the Phillies might add Montgomery because
– I know it.
Because Walker
– Walker's been bad.
Walker's been terrible. He got pulled after two-thirds tonight. He's terrible.
Yep.
Blew up his spot on Twitter earlier because he was eating too much friggin' popcorn and having too much of an icy at the movie theater last night seeing Dune 2. like you sat there and you bitched, moaned, and complained like a fucking schoolgirl after you didn't pitch in the postseason last year and you're liking shit about, you know, people talking shit on the manager. It's because you fucking suck. Yeah. You won 15 games last year because we averaged like 8 runs a game when you pitched.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. Get the hell
out of here. There's a little inflated. When you look at the American League, dude, for me, as long as it's not the Red Sox or the Astros, I'm pretty much, you know, it's not going to be us. So if it's not going to be us, it can't be either of those two teams, right?
Well, you have to think about the Red Sox.
No. Because they might be the only team in my division worse than us.
No.
So
Rafael Devers was calling out the team the other a couple weeks ago saying, hey.
Well, somebody on that roster needs to start speaking up.
Yeah, bring people in. What are we doing here? We're the Red Sox.
That's right.
Dude. The fact that they've let, like, you let Mookie, you traded Mookie.
Yeah.
Like, you should have given him the bag and let him and Devers be the cornerstones of your franchise for the next decade plus. And they ruined that. You do not trade a guy like that.
Mookie wanted out, though. He wanted out of Boston. And I believe there's a little bit more to it than just I want to go play somewhere else.
I think that's because he saw what transpired happening. He knew the direction of the franchise. Since when did the Red Sox become a bunch of cheap fucks?
Like, well, I think that's part of it.
I can't believe it.
I also think there's part of I do think there's something to the demeanor of a lot of folks in Boston.
You're thinking it's the racial tag?
I'm not saying that's all of it. I'm just saying that probably did not help. And I think that, you know, it's probably a culmination of everything we're talking about here. But I'm sure that played a role. It's not a secret. Boston, what was the other one? Who used to get razzed? Is it Salt Lake City?
Oh, when, Utah. With the Utah Jazz. Utah's big. Yeah. So, bunch of Mormon people banging their sisters.
That's it. Right.
Oh,
you can't marry everyone, so you just start banging your sister. You're still looking around.
Well, it's funny. WWE was there a few weeks ago, and The Rock was talking about how they have, like, you know, they have 10 wives. Right. Hey, WrestleMania's in town. 2 weeks, baby.
Yeah. Yeah, that's the other thing. I think we're going to drive up that Saturday.
You better.
Yeah. They're going to drive up and meet Rick.
Woo!
Yeah. It's still pretty cool he pulled that off, man. It's still pretty fucking that's awesome, really awesome, dude.
Very cool. I'm anxious to see. I'm not anxious. I really wish there was like a camera crew that was following Rick and Q around after the tailgate. I'm gonna be watching nights 1 and 2 WrestleMania at the link. But yeah. But when I'm off on Monday and I'm like laying around, I just want to see like a cut up real world version of Ric Flair and Quimby do Philadelphia.
Oh God.
Absolutely. And to the point where Ric Flair's yelling out, Q!
Did you guys ever see him do like an advertisement? He was advertising like a wing company. And he's like, wings! He's like, he goes, woo wings! Like in the wings. It's friggin' hilarious. I'll have to try and find it. Woo wings!
I'll try and see that.
All right. So Lou and I both had Atlanta and Baltimore. I'm going to go Baltimore over Atlanta, though.
I'd love
just
that.
Just because I think the Braves are good doesn't mean I like them. And the Braves can forever kiss my ass. I have an 8-game World Series winning streak against those motherfuckers. So the last 4 of 96 and all 4 of 99, dude. Out. Beat it. So I got that to hold on to.
That's right.
Final thoughts, guys. Lou.
No, just super excited for the season coming up. Like I said, baseball is my first love. I know it's your guys as well, and looking forward to a great season.
Chris?
Yeah, man. Dude, I love the group text. I love doing this stuff with you guys. You know, hopefully we can do it a little bit more often this year, especially because I don't have a show this season. I've had a couple different opportunities pop up, but, I don't know, man. I'm kind of to the point in my life now where I'm actually looking forward to enjoying the season and being able to spend the weekends, all the weekend with my family. So I'm looking forward to that aspect. Fun money is fun money. I don't need it. But but I'm looking forward to a great season all across the board. You know, I love going out in the patio on Friday and Saturday nights or Friday and or Saturday nights and enjoying a drink and a couple cigars with my feet kicked up by the fire pit and listen to the Phillies game. And then when I come inside and I've had a couple drinks and I've got the case of the munchies, I love putting on MLB Network and watching all the highlights and watching everything that's going on across Major League Baseball on the West Coast. It truly is the best sport. And I wish more people would get behind it like that, like they do with football. But hey man, you can't tell people what to love. Everybody has, I tell my wife all the time, teach their own. Everybody has something that they care more about. And that's how I feel about the game of baseball. It's been good to me in my lifetime. And I know it's been good to you guys as well.
Absolutely. Yes. Just to think back one more time about that. You know, look, you mentioned the patio, listening to radio, listen to, a game being called, painting the picture, the way Vince Scully used to do it.
The radio announcer.
Harry Callis for the Phillies for a long time. Yeah. There's nothing like it, man. The numbers, the chase, the longevity of the season, the boys of summer, everything just goes hand in hand with Americana, man. It's just incredible. You can't get that in a football game. It's too fast paced. Same thing with basketball. Same thing with hockey. Just the pace of baseball and how it all unwinds throughout the course of the summer, heading into the fall. You can't beat it, man. It's really amazing.
That's like you hear me tell people all the time. Baseball sucks. It's kind of a smart guy sport anyways. So,
sorry, Keenan.
It's the ultimate, right? It's the ultimate team sport. It at times, although without the double switch and stuff, it's not quite the chess match it used to be. And the way they've limited the way you can use relievers, but you still have some of that. I know you're dealing with Schwarber at the top of your lineup. don't worry, I don't have a prototypical leadoff hitter, anyways, man.
You're like a center fielder.
No, we're going to back DJ LeMahieu lead off, who hasn't done shit in 3 years. So, and he's our third baseman. Fantastic. But yeah, no, I agree with everything you guys said, man. It's baseball is the best sport. It's the best team sport. We'll do it on the projector in the garage fire pit, or I'll just sit out there with the radio announcers. I always find the radio announcers to most of the time be better than the TV announcers. Just because they're forced to fill in that time where you can watch a game and you can see what's going on. The TV announcers can just kind of let the game breathe. Radio, you don't have that. If you don't talk, it's just static. It's just white noise, so they have to keep it going. That's what made guys like Scully and Callis and guys like that so fantastic, telling the story of the game.
One of the best things, too, when you listen to it on the radio is the buildup. You hear the crowd. And, like, I could be sitting inside watching on TV, but there's nothing like Scott Fransky and Larry Anderson sitting there and, like, you hear swinging a drive. And you get that buildup to, like, you know, is it going to go? Is it out? Is it fair? And then, like, you know, that it's gone. And it's just, like, I'm sorry. Like, you can't do that with an air sport.
No.
You can't do it.
Doesn't work. Doesn't work. Trying to listen to a hockey game on the radio is like listening to a tobacco auction. That gets a little much. Basketball is not any better, though. Like, there's just so much movement that it's like, well, I guess the difference with hockey is everyone is Kucherov or it's a bunch of rush. Fuck, dude. Who's got the puck? Like, until you hear somebody stop it, right? Saved by Shesterkin. Okay, now I know it's now I know where the puck is.
And they don't tell you the score enough, like you know.
No. But they don't have any time to breathe.
Yeah.
I mean, where are you going to get a score in there? You know, it's like the Micro Machines commercials from when we were kids. Where's it? Brrr, 2-1. Brrr. Can't get it in there. All right, guys, ready to wrap it up?
Yeah, let's put a bow on it.
Yo, thank you guys for being here tonight, man. This was a lot of fun. Yeah, whenever you guys want, this platform is always here for you. Do you guys have anything you want to plug before we exit here?
Yeah, my hair.
I'm getting there.
Getting close too, man.
Hey, you already put a ring on Ash, so you don't have to worry about it anymore.
Right, let it go.
I'm not only the client, but I'm also – I'm not only the president, but I'm also a client, I guess. The old just for
Lou, you guys got anything coming up you want to share?
Yeah, no, we're going to wait for this schedule to come out. And, you know, last year we got a little derailed with the Kansas City Tyreek game going overseas. So we're hoping to get it together here. We got 305 Sports Travel is a business that we launched last year. And trying to – we did a bunch of great watch parties in L.A., New England, highlighted by going to Kansas City in frigid temperatures for that playoff game. And we did it all in the name of fandom. We love our team. And so, yeah, we're hoping to have a nice run this year with the schedule release.
Good. Yep. I know we're looking forward to it here, too. The Green Legion for early bird deposits being accepted now for every away game. Yeah. So we're on board for New Orleans. Hopefully those dates work out. And, you know, for anybody who's got the means and wants to travel out here, you can come see yours truly right here in Cincinnati this year and also see your birds play here. So
opening day show, Quimby and I believe it's going to be from 11 to noon on Fox Sports The Gambler. So make sure next Thursday, 11 to noon. And then at that point, I can drink for 3 hours until first pitch.
There you go. And as for this show, we'll be back next week, regularly scheduled time, which I have now moved to Fridays because it's just fucking easier for me. I'm not so rushed during the week, although if I could do this at 8 o'clock every Wednesday, I'd be fine because there's no rush. Doing it at 6 like I had been before got a little nuts. But, yeah, we're pretty much on Fridays now going forward. So, guys, Chris, Lou, thank you for being here. Everybody who was in the room, all 142 of you still left here.
God dang.
Much appreciated. And that's actually low, dude. Last week, Quimby and I both went over 200 on right on cue in on this one.
I was with you guys. Yeah.
And then this just last night, we were up to 360-something while the show was going on. So something's happened. And he was talking to me afterwards. He's like, where is this coming from? I said, dude, it started happening a couple of months ago. The Twitter numbers went through the roof. I don't know if it's bots or what's going on, but the Twitter numbers went way, way up, dude. Was like right before, and it took a little bit of a dip after the Facebook page got hacked. But now it's starting to buoy back up again. Yeah.
Everybody loves watching elephant porn. So
apparently, right? So, all right, guys, girls, we're going to get out of here. You guys have a good night. Thank you guys for coming on here, man. Appreciate it.
Later, boys. We'll have soon. A good night.
Later.
Good night. Take care, guys. All right, y'all. Anybody who's still in the room, thank you for being here. We're going to close out a little differently this time. Again, big thank you to Chris and Lou for being with us tonight. Hope to do that again at another date. Till then, folks, this has been the Unhappy Gilmore Show, powered by Green Legion Radio, part of the Green Legion Radio family. We will see you next week. Take care, y'all. Love you.